This program is brought to you by Hungry Jack's and Bunnings Trade.
Challenging start to the season for the Sydney Kings, but it's all starting to come together for them, and the picture just became a whole lot clearer. In the last couple of weeks, all of the discussion has been around who they would sign as their replacement for RJ Hunter. They have got their man, Ian Clark, with 371 games of NBA experience, joins the Kings lineup at the right time of the season. Hello and welcome to Game 2 on our Sunday doubleheader in the Hungry Jack's NBL. It's the Kings taking on the Bullets. Jack Heverin joined in commentary by Andrew Gaze and Pete Hooley. Great to see both of you. And Ian Clark's a really big name to bring to this league.
Well, they have. The Sydney Kings have really navigated this difficult start to the season with injuries really well. They've won four out of the last five. And Ian Clark is a outstanding signing. Now, we all know it takes a little time to adjust, but what he's done throughout the course of his career is one that you think is going to slot in very, very nicely. As we take a look at the starting lineups for the Brisbane, a very quick look at the starting lineups for the Brisbane Bullets. But instead, I think we need to focus on what Sydney is doing because they have been, Adams in particular and Martin, I think, have really been the nucleus for what they've been able to do and how they've been able to score. And the main man is Xavier Cooks. He has just been a delight to watch and a presence for the Sydney Kings this season.
We'll get to Xavier Cooks very shortly, but let's get courtside to Shane Heal, who's part of our team this afternoon. Hammer, Ian Clark, it's a fairly big addition for the Kings.
The Kings are back, fellas. Don't worry about that. There's some excited ownership over here to my left and some fans as well. Good things are happening. And you're right, Drewy. Now they've got over their injury problems. A lot of people wrote the Kings off, but they're starting to look really good. And they could well have the best import combination in the entire league once Cooks gets going. But he's going to take some time. Hasn't played for 10 months as well.
Well, speaking of Xavier Cooks, Hulls, let's talk about him. And has he now entered the MVP discussion with the form that he's enjoying in the last month?
Well, the discussion's right now with Bryce Cotton, so he's in his own island. But Xavier Cooks, what he does, he's not going to put up the 30 points a game, but he does so many other things so well. He was outstanding in this game, the 23 points. But he just fits this team, this system really well. The defensive end is where he's had a lot of success as well. He's knocking down the three ball. That changes the way that you have to guard Xavier Cooks. He's just a problem. But a lot of the time, he's getting fed the ball from a guy like Jalen Adams. He works so well with Martin down low, and he's just a guy that if you want him, you need him on your team. If you want to be successful, Xavier Cooks is the type of player you need to have alongside you.
And Hammer, for Xavier Cooks, plus 93 on the floor in his last six games. He leads the competition by a long way in the plus minus stat.
Well, it's not a surprise, is it? We know he's a star, but he's not a star that needs a lot of usage. He gets all his points off other people. He picks, he rolls, he gets to the right spot. He's got a great feel for the game. Good offensive rebounder, defender, does a little bit of everything. So he's the perfect star to be able to complement these other players the Kings have got.
The DoorDash starting lineup for the Brisbane Bullets. Get 25% off your next four orders. Just use the code PASS IT. No Nathan Sobey again today for the Brisbane Bullets, unfortunately. But in his absence on Friday night in their win over Adelaide, it was that man on your screen right now, Lamar Patterson, who's having a really, really good season, but he had a big one against the 36ers.
They needed him too. And that was a win that they absolutely must have had. And Lamar Patterson, this is Lamar Patterson of old. He's had 13 points in the first quarter. When the game was there to be taken over and won, this man said, I'm going to take over. And that's what he did, hitting threes, doing a bit of everything. Six assists, five steals again. Just did a super efficient rate. And Lamar Patterson's in this mindset. This is what is good for the Bullets, because with no Nathan Sobey, they need someone to take over the game. And what I love about what James Duncan did, let him play the point guard for a little bit when Jason Kadee sat down. This guy kind of sealed it. Have a look at this. Lamar Patterson getting up, raising the roof. I never expected Lamar Patterson to be raising the roof.
Hammer, this is a big one for the Bullets. They're 5-7 on the season. A loss today, it kind of sees them drift away from that top bracket.
A team that can just pull one out of the bag and beat some of the top teams, but just haven't shown the consistency to be able to get it done. But with that man on screen, if he gets firing, they're a chance.
Third meeting of the season between these two teams, and the game ball is on the way out to the middle of Kudos Bank Arena. And here's the line, Drew.
Oh, nice.
Put it in the back of the DoorDash.
Oh, DoorDash. Just coming out there and providing the delivery service that is accustomed to the NBL.
Just sums up DoorDash by any means necessary. Halls, a car, a bike, a scooter.
Well, we can guarantee the DoorDash we've used in Mike Leland just going in to have a little look. Jeez, it'd be...
That's if there was a...
We can guarantee the DoorDash will... There might be someone on a scooter. It'll be a lot quicker than that. We've proven that. Get our DoorDash Pico.
That might work. The third meeting of the season between the Bullets and the Kings. They played twice in round eight. Brisbane winning the first one, 96-87. Sydney winning the second game of that weekend, 97-73. Frank short on the first three ball.
Clearly they want to get Franks going, but one pass and Cook's penetrating. But the one pass to let a three fly, I usually preferred if you down a little bit in his last few games hasn't been as explosive as he was at the start of the season. You're usually trying to get at least have a look at something a little cheaper than just coming out and blazing away from the three-point line. Salt getting a start as well. Big body provides that rebounding and more of a threat probably on the defensive end, and offensively sets a screen, picks and dives. But tough matchup for Salt.
Jalen Adams has been such a reason why the Kings are in a bit of a purple patch, pardon the pun, right now. This is that one from underneath.
I think Hammer's right, though, when you think of their three imports. And that's more like I was thinking, to at least have a look at that option to get something cheap, and that time it does pay off. But as Hammond mentioned, with Clark, Martin and Adams, that is, to me, that's a spot on perfect combination as an import combo.
There is Adams. There was some discussion about whether that was the right type of player for the Kings, whether they perhaps needed to go bigger peak. What do you think?
Well, time will tell. We know Jordan Hunter's out for the season, but Jarrell Martin and Xavier Cooks are loving the way they play in that front court. So just to stock up on the guards and have Vasiljevic has been playing well. You know, Swaka the Bullock's been upgraded, so that's going to be a nice little piece to figure out. But I already thought that arguably the Kings had one of the best trios in the league. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely up there. And there you had Ian Clark, so looking forward to seeing him.
He is suited up today, but pretty unlikely that we'll see him. Only landed in Sydney yesterday. Krebs, nice look for three. 31% shooter from outside across the season. Gives Brisbane an early lead.
It's just nice to see them. Lamar Patterson making those decisions, because he's just such a good decision maker with the ball in his hands. Really patient.
Martin. That time. Kadee in this starting lineup in the absence of Nathan Sobey. Brisbane trying to get Franks involved early. He's had a couple of looks.
It's going to be a big matchup, Cooks versus Franks, because Franks hit a couple of those against the Adelaide 36ers, but what he's having to do this against now is the athleticism and the length and the ability of Xavier Cooks, because you don't create as much space. It might look like that step back's there, unless you really drop Xavier Cooks to the floor. See how his late contest on that move, long outstretched arm.
Sub coming. Hang on, boys.
Xavier Cooks in their last three games at home. The form of some of their stars has been outstanding. Jalen Adams averaging 21 points a game, 6 rebounds, 7 assists at home. DJ Vasiljevic shooting at 50% from the field. Starting to click into a nice rhythm now, particularly on their home floor.
Well, they don't have a lot of... This is their 10th home game, so they only have 4 after this one, so it's... They're going to be spending a lot of the remainder of the season on the road.
Patterson from well beyond the arc.
That's feeling good. Oh, Patterson, still a little in and out he put. In the start of that possession. Jalen Adams flying over to Swaka Lepulik. Patterson everywhere right now. And Harrison into the game after just 3.5 minutes to start this one. The Jack Salt, he's been starting the last couple of games. James Duncan looking for something new and hasn't worked out just yet.
Chase Buford won't be happy with that. Cadiz stole it away. And the three doesn't go down. 3 of 9 from the field to start off here, the Bullets. Vasiljevic gave it up for Adams. Not that time.
We've seen this, and that's why I like the signing of Clark, because sometimes they do go have these spells on offense, and it looks like it's going to be an offensive foul. Swaka Lepulik does a good job to get in front, but there are times when, even despite the talent they have, that they have had these runs where offensively they just haven't been able to score. And I reckon with Clark and what he can do and create his own shot will help alleviate some of those times when scoring has really been tough.
They're going to be very heavy in the guard. Angus Glover, we saw he did the other night, this clutch three ball. He's been playing well. I know Swaka Lepulik got upgraded to that roster spot, but Vasiljevic, he's been pretty good this season. We know he can get hot quickly, so things to juggle around. And I think they might have so many options of being a little smaller, maybe playing Vasiljevic at the three.
They already do that this season. They play that five-out spread offense, and even right now, it's basically four guards and Jarrell Martin on the floor as we speak. So they do spread it out a lot.
Swaka Lepulik drives and scores with one to come.
I think it's safe to say, Gabe, nothing basically about it. They have got four guards out there.
Yeah.
And Jarrell Martin, Swaka Lepulik in the four spot. And this is why, when you come up against the Bullets, this is something they've done since the start of the season. And they did it in the Andre Lemanis era as well. Is a lot of the time they will have play small themselves. They throw Robert Franks out there. And what do you do? How do you adjust? They've got Harrison out there and Chase Buford saying, OK, well, it's our turn. We've got a lot of forward guards out there and see what we can exploit.
If you're Brisbane right now, and how do we counter that? We counter with our offense and just trying to exploit it. We look at some of the matchups there. This one on your screen as we speak with Franks, he should have an advantage. Or defensively, do you camouflage it? Maybe looking at some zone, take away that penetration, see what they're going to do from the three-point line. And
nice play there to get Isaiah Moss open. His first points in the game. Adams, top of the key. 0 from 5 to start with.
Oh, that's not a shot. That was an attempted lob pass by Jason Kadee. The idea was right. And with this size mismatches up there for Brisbane, trying to throw it in down low is a good option.
Vasiljevic catch and shoot.
This is something that the Bullets, I know they won the game against the Sixers, didn't do really well with Robert Franks. Now, you've got a bit of a mismatch here, height-wise, here, Angus Glover down there. He needs to get the ball, he's back to the basket on the block. We know he can shoot step-back threes, but right now, got to demand the ball. See Jarrell Martin trying to come across, get the flash now for Harrison. But right here, and Kings are probably going to live with that. So, how do you do that? You put Harrison on the other side of the block. They're going to stop the lob play, and that's why you think James Duncan, okay, maybe we have to throw a small ball lineup out there. So if they're going to guard it that way with Franks, we can have some success.
Kings have got some issues shooting the basketball in this opening quarter. They're 2 of 13. Brisbane not a lot better than 4 of 11. Isaiah Moss from the free throw line makes that 4 of 12 for the Bullets. Martin, head down to the basket. Had it stripped away from him by Franks. And Drimmick up ahead. Doesn't get it to go either. And Glover looks for Jarrell Martin. He likes that spot.
He's really comfortable on the three-point line. In fact, some would say can sometimes be a little critical of him for floating to the three-point line a little bit more than he should, but more than capable.
Great finish, Drimmick. He wanted the extra. Chase Buford calls a timeout. 2 minutes and 59 remaining in this opening quarter.
Well, here's what I'm talking about, the penetration there, and wide open, and that's going to be there if you need help.
That's what he's going to do. Todd Harrison's going to stay low, so he's going to hunt that three-point line. Try and make him change that.
Hey, yeah, we're getting some decent looks down here, haven't made a couple, but I think we're also settling for a couple, all right? Keep attacking. Keep going multiple actions. If they're red, look to hit the pocket. If it's not there, just get off it quick. Get it to the other side. 0.5 basketball, all right? Let's pick it up a little bit. Right here, let's go ear tug kick. Jalen, you got it right here. SB, you're right here. Tommy, go get him. Angus, get through. Hit SB. Tommy, go get him. Come off. Hit JA. Rel, you flying into that step up right there. Sorry, X, you're flying in this step up right there. If JA is denied, X, you flash early. Hit him on the handoff, all right? Look for the rolls. Here we go. Defense on three. One, two, three. Defense.
Keep an eye on this play. Chase Buford's drawn up. And last time a Sydney Kings play, what they do really well is give Xavier Cooks a running start into an on-ball screen. And to be honest, when Jalen Adams has the ball on the on-ball screen, he picks apart a ball screen situation so well. One of the best in the league at it, whether he's looking for his own shot or the pocket pass or the skip pass. And it makes it a lot easier for him if there's been some separation on whoever's guarding Xavier Cooks, and he sprints into the screen, and then he'll roll out of it to his short corner, where that's a good situation for Xavier Cooks to be in. So we'll see what they can get through here.
Sean Bruce out there for his first minutes. Bogdanović wide open.
There's a stumbling of the feet, but regardless, if he had a fall on over, Tyra Harrison was going to be wide open. And good execution coming out of the timeout. Just while we got a little pause here, some great news for Australians in the NBA, in particular Josh Giddey, who's been a sensation. He picked up his second triple-double today.
Wow.
11 points, 12 rebounds, 10 assists against the Chicago Bulls.
Magnificent.
Just can't play a bit.
I think he's got a future, the boy.
Yeah, might be okay. Jock Landau had a pretty good day
as well.
Yes,
that trade that you were talking about earlier. I'm not sure if you did that on air or off air, but that trade that allows...
Oh, that was another off air conversation that's made it on air.
Jock Landau. Probably we don't mind this one on...
Oh, this one's on air. Harrison. That's Patterson. Not ding ding against the shot clock. It goes. Brisbane lead by 5. Ding ding with his first points in the game. Played a nice role on Friday.
And that's where Xavier Cooks is really, really good on the offensive end. Just makes the really smart reads. Puts himself in the right spot. You don't pick him up. You don't bump the body. He's going to get to that and rise up and finish.
Glover trying to chase Patterson around. And he's throwing that one away.
And, you know, Lamar Patterson is really good on the low block. And then this, with this mass mismatch, we see Deng Deng spot up. But with this mismatch with Glover on him, go to Patterson on the box and see how they're going to adjust, because even if he's not going to score, he's going to create a mismatch, because you're going to have to come and provide some help. And he's so good at distributing the ball.
Wiley Bayless, coming back from injury. Good to see him out there. And Xavier Cooks, and that's something that he does exceptionally well. It was his movement that got Wiley Bayless the open three. And if you don't box him out, Jack Salt is the bigger body, but you've got to drive Xavier Cooks as far away from possible, because if the ball is in the area, his length and athleticism is just going to pick it over the top.
Yeah. Fourth in the competition for offensive rebounds, Xavier Cooks.
He's averaging 9 rebounds a game across both offense and defense.
Glover, nice knockdown. Puts the Kings back in front.
And you're spot on right now, Gazy. They have to get the ball in the low block with Lamar Patterson, because it's not whole. It's not going to be forced up. He's going to make the right decision. He's a willing passer. And so often he draws a double team that he gets guys open shots. And there you go. He read that perfectly, that the defense was just cheating off Anthony Drimmick. Fired it across to him, and that's a big knockdown for Anthony Drimmick, who's just shooting 23% on three this season.
This Bawali Bales, his first game back today from an ankle injury.
Mm. Fourth team foul of Brisbane. Sydney yet to register a foul in the contest.
Kings looking to make it three in a row, coming off wins against Southeast Melbourne and New Zealand. If you have just joined us earlier today, the Phoenix winners over Tasmania. Cooks misses Vidanovic altogether.
And of course, we're hyping up his decision making and misses Angus Glover, who is wide open on the wing, and he said it straight after. They get that a lot, though. They did that last season as well. That's something we know how Xavier Cooks works.
To block to finish off the quarter.
It's Falcon.
And insult to injury for Tamari Wignes. Cops the ball right in the face. At quarter time, it's Brisbane who lead 20-17 here in the Hungry Jacks NBL. It's Sunday Hoops, don't go too far. The second quarter is coming up next. Watching Sunday Hoops in the Hungry Jacks NBL. Game two of our Sunday doubleheader. The Bullets leading it by three at quarter time. 1-1, these two teams playing against each other this season. Still a long way to go in this game. The winner of our $50 Kmart gift card is Emily Heitbaum, enjoying the home games in our first season following the NBL, which is great to see. And the Bullets will be pretty happy with the way they've started this game.
Always good to be leading in quarter time when you're playing in the opponent's venue. Mark Patterson had a big say in that. Only the 3 points, but four assists, three rebounds. Doing a bit of everything.
This Cooks at the foul line. That foul will be called on Deng Deng as we get courtside to Shane Hill.
Yeah, good start for the Bullets in that first quarter, but I think if they're going to win this game on the road, Jason Kadee needs to get more involved. He had a donut on Thursday night in their win. Nine assists, though, but I think he needs to balance it. We know he's a great three-point shooter. He's 0-for-3 in the first quarter, but I reckon he's at his best when he puts the ball on the ground, gets into the key, draws fouls, and creates for teammates as well. Love to see him get some points in these last three quarters.
I think Hammer's spot on, and with no Nathan Sobey, it means that he's really running the point, and I wouldn't mind if they put the ball in Lamar Patterson's hands as the point guard and have Jason Kidd out there just playing off the ball, that's going to open him up a bit more to hunt his own shot and to get the open looks when the defense is worried about Patterson, because he's a smart operator too. He's thinking, okay, I'm in the point guard, we have no Nathan Sobey, let me get everybody involved. That's why he had the nine dimes, but trying to find that balance, especially with a key piece out.
Well, he's good in on-ball situations as well, Jason Kidd. He reads the situation well and can find people and understands what the defense is doing in order to penalize whatever strategy they're using in the on-balls.
Shot clock expires.
That one right there, Robert Franks is, you've got to get out to your spot quick enough. That ball comes from Lamar Patterson. It's 1-2, let it fly. Lamar Patterson did the right thing again. Just surveying the defense, okay. Your man's cheating in a little bit. Here's an open look.
Martin had Bales baseline. Idea was right. They overplay that handoff. The back door was on. And then just the pass on the back door was a little sloppy. And Bales tried to salvage a bad pass. There we see Kadee coming back into the contest. So Shane Hill got a direct contact with James Duncan just to get things done.
Top 10 in the competition for assists, Jason Kidd. Patterson fires away, not that time.
That's what we're talking about. He's trying to set up the play, and for a little bit, it looked a bit like semi-pro. Just you want it, who wants it? Put him on the wing. Good knockdown from Bawali Bales. Lamar Patterson is still trying to control the show because Lamar Patterson's getting people opportunities to shoot the ball. That can be Jason Kidd right now.
Bit like semi-pro.
Yeah.
This pass for Deng Deng. Who's going to wrestle the bear?
Spumoni. Spumoni.
Easy, boys. Easy. Hey, hey,
hey. A bit of extracurricular here.
Something didn't really look like a whole lot.
Goes, I reckon there's a bit of mayonnaise here. So Wiley Bales, there's the foul call, and he wasn't happy with that. So, oh, Wiley just said, here you go.
You know, Krebs didn't do anything wrong. Maybe he thought he tripped him or something, but Wiley Bales there, unless there's something happened prior, looked like a little overreaction, and I think that's going to penalise his team. There might be some penalties of throwing the ball directly at Krebs on the ground. It wasn't a hard throw or anything.
Did you guys miss DJ Vasilovic? Straight away put his hand straight in front of his face. Didn't know what was coming next at that time, but he played peacemaker unlike that Perth game a couple of weeks ago, so good to see he's learned.
Well, I'm wondering if the only thing was maybe Riley Bales thought that Tony Krebs was trying to have a little hold on the way down. There we go, a bit of a review.
See, here's the thing.
Mayonnaise and no more.
I don't know how close you are to the action there, but Wiley Bales just threw the ball back. Now, it wasn't a hard throw, but from some of the things we've seen called throughout the course of the season, usually that would bring about some type of penalty.
Shot clock down to four. Swaka the Bullock trying to get inside.
Oh, sort of a nothing offense from the Sydney Kings. And right now, Jalen Adams, all five from the field. He's got two assists. Put the ball in his hand. Let him create. We speak about how much Lamar Patterson is a key for that for the Bullets. Jalen Adams, he's got to be like that on the offensive end right now for the Kings.
Frank steps out for three. It's good.
We'll find a way to get him going and involved more. He's only had the four field goal attempts. And that's what he's capable of doing. After the first five or six rounds, he was one of the best players in the competition. Mm.
15 points in their win over Adelaide on Friday. Rebound for Deng Deng. Brisbane with a chance to extend this lead. Shot clock into single numbers. Patterson. That will be an offensive foul.
Absolutely. There's no doubt about that. Aaron Patterson just looks where was else. And here we go. This is a bit in this.
So
Maybe Cook's just telling Robert Franks it's basketball, so he's correct. He pretty much is.
He's been finding himself in a few of these little to and fro's in the last few weeks, Xavier Cooks.
Let's go, let's play. Then you'll be honest for being too technical. Hands.
James Duncan. That's asking the question, and there's the foul on Franks.
Well, his hands are all over Jarrell Martin there. It's always a tough cover because Jarrell Martin can put the ball on the floor. Got a whole array of moves. Yes, Xavier Cooks and Lamar Patterson. So Xavier Cooks tries to help him up, and Lamar Patterson says, no, I'll go with Robert Franks. And Cooks will probably just turn around and had a couple words to say.
I'm sure they'll work it out.
Just basketball, Jack.
Just basketball. Spot on.
That was a great take from Deng Deng. Way to read
two
the play.
Thanks, mate. Two purple. Up it.
Started to find a nice spot in this Brisbane rotation. Deng Deng not putting up huge numbers on the season, but making his minutes count, averaging about 15 a game.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's his role, and he's got to build on it from there. And sometimes you can gum in, and we've got those relatively limited minutes. You can try and do too much in that short period of time. Take what's given to you, chip away, build on that rather than just trying to come out and explode. And by and large, he's done that.
There's Kadir in the corner. Offensive rebound by Terrell Harrison. Bullets are retained possession. Only 2 points and two rebounds on Friday night. Harrison made such a big start to the season. Missed a couple of games through injury. Hulls and hasn't quite come back the same.
No, he hasn't. I think that's why James Duncan is throwing Jack Salt out there to start, just to see something different.
Late in the clock again, Brisbane. Kadir gets all the way in and lays it up.
As you said, Drew, he reads those ball screens well and get caught on the screen. Realise that this shot clock's running down, but you've got enough time to turn the corner if you go hard enough.
They scored the last 7 points in the game, Brisbane. Having a nice little period. Adams is now 0 from 6. Nice pass. Martin had the seal. Good hands. Kadir knocks it out of play.
Really on that play, Jarrell Martin, there was a switch, and Jason Kadir had switched on to him. And rather than directly just running to the box and demanding it, he picked, popped, stayed out, and eventually they were able to get some sort of mismatch. And here we see a foul, and Swaka the Bullet's going to go to the line from a three-point play. But they're the types of options that, you know, again, might be a little old school, but what that happened previously? Just go run, sprint straight to the box, spread everyone out and try and exploit it straight away. The way the game's played, and with Martin himself as well, who can hit that three, that sometimes it's almost you're looking at him and you think, does he realise he's got a 6-1 guy on him?
Can't make the extra. 3-point game at Kudos Bank Arena. Will be an offensive foul on Anthony Drimmitt. Angus Glover.
He hooked him as he was running. I think he was actually trying to draw the foul because of the tight defense and just used his arm to hook it and got called for it on Drimmitt. Delay of game, I think it is, as well.
He rolled the ball away from all three referees.
That'll get you a delay of game most of the time. Mm.
That's going to be an off. Absolutely. That's as clear cut as it comes as well.
Easy call.
And again, you're not going to really get anything out. So Sean Bruce is coming off. They want to get into the ball screen. That's just the start of the possession. So Jarrell Martin, there's no need to do that. I know you're trying to set the tone and make sure every screen is as aggressive as possible. But it's going towards the Bunnings trade logo. Just stand still. Let Sean Bruce rub the defender into you.
Spot on. And that play was really just the screens there just to allow him to catch the ball, not to necessarily create a scoring opportunity. And he picks up a foul.
Glover up ahead. Combines with Swaka the Bullet. Nice transition offense from the Kings. James Duncan has seen enough. It's back to a one-point game. 27-26.
Well, it's been a grind, and those transition baskets become a whole lot more valuable when you're struggling a little bit in the half court. And great hands by Glover. Instant touch pass back.
That's when the shot goes up. It's not always going to go in. Sprint back. Non-negotiables. Sprint back and make him earn it. All right? Good. Watch the press here. Next time we're going to go snap four for LP. All right, snap four. You're going to get it in the post. You're catching it. Guard come off. Set it up. All right, LP, you got it in the post. Go to work. We have post cutting after that.
Jenny, so we get it done, do you mind if I just throw it and then go get the handoff instead of the corner guy running?
Yes, yes, yes,
yes,
yes. So he's going to get the handoff. All right, we just need the cross screen for LP.
There you go, Gazy. You call for it. They're looking to get Lamar Patterson in the low post where we keep harping on about it. He's just such a good decision maker. And he wants everybody else moving off the ball. Have those cuts for that exact reason. If you cut and you're open, he will find you.
And Jason Kadee there just shortening the play. So there was a little bit of action before that cross screen. And Jason Kadee said, well, if that's going to be our destination, let's get rid of the little loop action in order to get there. So straight cross screen for Patterson rather than going through a little handoff and misdirection. So good call, and good on James Duncan to say, well, okay, well, I'm concerned about getting Lamar Patterson the ball. If you guys can figure out a way to get there a little quicker, no problem with it. And there we go. Oh, that's going to be a charge, I think.
Well, it is. Angus Glover was just standing down there, bracing for the contact.
Offensive foul.
You know?
It is. It's... Lamar Patterson's got to be a little bit more alert of what they're doing. Now, that's a tough one because Glover kind of jumps in front of him. It's technically the correct call.
You don't like it because of the fact that Lamar Patterson's not even looking. He's just trying to get to his spot.
Yeah.
And their worst one is in transition when you've got a big run in the lane and someone stops. Again, letter of the law. Standing still and you clean him up, it's going to be an offensive foul.
Adams playing through contact. It was a late call.
Foul, I like that. And I like that because it's a foul. So, yes, you tried to see what could come of it and then a little fumble there. You still called a late call.
Just his fifth game of the season, Isaiah Moss. Dealing with a serious hamstring injury that kept him out for a big part of the season. Adams. He's on the board with his first point of the game. Sixth in the competition for steals. Third in the competition for assists per game. Fourth in the competition for points per game.
Solid numbers. And he's actually a better shooter, I believe, than what his numbers would indicate as well. He's only shooting it at 38% from the field, 32% from the three-point line. And I think that's more a product of the injuries and not having an ideal preseason to get ready, and he's only going to get better from based on what I've seen as the season rolls on.
Only played 9 of their 14 games coming into today. Patterson again late in the clock. Bullets using all of it. Harrison tips it back out. Cadiz open. Cooks takes control of the ball for Sydney. Adams screams up the other end and scores.
That's what he can do. Scores in a variety of ways. It's been hard to come by for him so far in this one.
The Kings now are on an 8-0 run. They've managed to get things going in their direction. Patterson can't make it happen.
They've done a good job of keeping the hot man quiet. Patterson, 1 of 4 from the field to restrict him. Only 4 field goal attempts is a good effort.
There you go. You got to stop getting out and run before the defense is set, because that last possession from the Sydney Kings on the defense, man, that was solid. The last two, everybody was moving. A couple of opportunities, the Bullets could have explored something, and they really were just trying to focus on getting to the end of the set. Now, That works when you're really trying to slow it down, but you know the way that these two teams like to play. If you're the Brisbane Bullets, we talked a bit about Jason Kennedy being a playmaker. You got to at least have a little bite of the cherry on everything. Is there something there for me to explore? If it's early, the defense break down, that might be the best shot you get in that possession. It just looked like they were trying to get to the end of the offense.
Now, that's true. I think there is a fine line because Sydney, with the way they've shown winning four of the last five times, they can push it up. They want to attack and they're prepared to really go hard at the rim early in the offense. And is that two missed there? No, just the one. The way the crowd was getting excited, I thought there might have been burgers coming their way, but
silly bit. Haven't scored in the game as yet. And Bruce off to Jarrell Martin. Looks good.
Well, right now, and we've seen it all season from Jarrell Martin, you've got to close out and respect him as a shooter. Yes, you're doing your job about playing in the lanes, using your body as the help level. But when he catches it out there, make him put the ball on the floor.
And Franks deep on the three. 5 of 17 from outside in this one, Brisbane. Franks gets it back. One-on-three situation. Took it himself and scores with the left hand.
Really forced it, but such is the skill.
That's the one we were talking about, Daisy.
Yeah.
That's going to be called a block, though. So here's a little slap behind from Lamar Patterson. This is tough. This is one-on-three. Sean Bruce does well to wall up. And then that foul in transition.
Oh, look at the great one, Mr. Magic himself. Gee whiz, looking sharp.
How fit does he look?
Steve, one of the greats of the Sydney King history, actually started with the Hobart Devils, if you don't mind. And that's where he did early on. Mate, came into the league and made an absolute splash. Tore it to shreds, scoring, passing. And then did some very sharp work behind the microphone.
Sure did. Let's get to Hammer.
How good does Steve Carfino look? In love and happy and skinny. Looked like he wanted to grab the microphone there and belt out a bit of a tune because we know he can sing as well. But just wanted to talk about DJ Vasiljevic. Hasn't scored in this game. Only 4 points between him and Adams. They average 32 between them. I think he's a really important piece and somebody they need to run a couple of plays for to get him feeling good about himself. They're a better team when he's firing.
He's only had the one shot, Hammer, so you're right. Like they saw in that last time out with James Duncan trying to get Lamar Patterson a touch on the block, just get a set for him just to get him going.
And that's Xavier Cooks, his bread and butter. Yes, Jack Salt, you're the bigger body, but he's going to get to his spot and rise up. And the Vasiljevic one, he's an outstanding piece to the Kings puzzle. When Ian Clark starts to find his traps, that's going to be something they have to figure out. How do we keep everybody involved? Because they're all such good pieces for them to go forward. And that's why you like having everything done at the start of the season. Good pick up from Robert Franks to finish.
What about the body control? Read that situation beautifully with the spin. And that's an instinctive spin because that happened so quick.
Salt knocked it away from Cooks. Did a nice job defensively. And Bullets down three. Franks is starting to have an influence. Draws a foul.
French is the one, we know how good he can be. And it's been quiet a couple of games lately. But it's all about putting him in the right spots. If he's got a smaller guard on him, like we've seen Angus Glover have to guard him. But as you said, guys, yeah, it's instinctive just reading where Xavier Cooks is. Put him on the block with it back to the basket. He likes to face up, little step back. And if he's got Xavier Cooks, then bring Xavier Cooks away from the basket on the perimeter and trying to get him screens. We've seen him trying to get those flare screens to open up the three-point shot. I think the Bullets just have to be a little smarter overall of who is guarding Robert Franks, and then let's change the offense when we see that in the half court.
I really like this guy. I think that he's a high-energy guy. Doesn't seem to soak it up if he's not getting the touches he needs and doesn't always need the ball to be having an influence. He rebounds it a little over 8 a game. And 16 points a game. I think there's still a little bit more left in the tank when it comes to Franks as well.
No doubt, that's what we're talking about, just in the balance of when to go at him, where to put him on the floor. Oh, my.
Xavier Cooks took it upstairs.
Defense. We already had one of the dunks of the year the other night. Just tried to back that up.
Patterson. Can't bank at home. There's 3 points in this game.
Chase Buford, I think, has caught the technical foul.
This is becoming a fairly regular occurrence.
Are you that soft?
Be careful. It's always disappointing when you've picked up a tech.
You've
got to be walking a real thin line because you feel like you didn't get value for money in that tech.
Whistle. I got it. Where are you? Say, blow your whistle, Elliot. That's what it's for.
Ooh. Yeah, he said that quietly. That unfortunately, we could hear it, but it's if that's all he did say.
Thanks, buddy.
Blow your whistle. No, maybe it's the accumulation,
you know exactly
maybe, or the
Chase.
Whole bunch of things.
Three plays you chased me, mate.
There you go.
Blow it there for us one time.
Accumulation, that's the one. Daisy, you said it, and therefore you explained. Said it three times in a row.
Yellow 17,
1-7. Hand check. Even if you said blow your whistle three times, after all the stuff that we hear coaches say,
no doubt.
I think you've got to say it more than three times before you. Deserving of a tee.
I'm wondering if there was some sort of warning or just told, look, you've had your crack now. But I'm with you, Gazy, and it wasn't all that long ago that you were on the sideline down there having a little bark.
It's pretty polite.
Not always.
Friendly polite.
We must have been watching some different games.
No, it's... Sometimes you get caught up in the theatrics of it all.
And sometimes you think about when coaches get technical fouls, it's to kind of set the point of emphasis, and then referees will start to be a little bit more understanding and focus on what you're complaining about. So, but they were up like two before that. So Chase Buford trying to say, look, we need a whistle down the other end. And 14 fouls to four in King's favour. I mean, Bullock's got 14, King's have only got four.
Whistle has been blowing.
Addison almost lost it.
To the stats.
Got it back. Moss is a shooter. That one doesn't stick. Krebs kept it alive. Might get another chance. Misses from underneath. Maybe one more. Scrappy end of the second quarter. The Kings lead 39-35. There's a bit of emotion out there right now.
It is, and after a slow start by the Sydney Kings with their shooting, they were able to figure out a way to get the tempo going their way, and things started to tick over for them. And in contrast, the Brisbane Bullets really struggling to score in that second quarter and find some good scoring options.
22 points to 15 in that quarter as we get to Shane Hill.
Got Jarrell Martin. A bit scrappy in the first half, but you still find yourself in front.
Yeah, we started off a bit slow, but you know, we picked up our momentum, so we got to keep coming out and executing in the second half.
Now, the new man probably won't play a little bit today, but pretty exciting time for these fans to be able to see the new American come to town.
Yeah, no, it's definitely exciting. You know, we can't wait to have him aboard and help get us some wins.
Okay, good luck in the second half, mate. Well done.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
It's 39-35. Jarrell Martin has had a good say on proceedings so far. The Kings looking to make their streak continue. They've been in good form of recent times, fifth on the table. But the Bullets aren't just going to give it to them. We'll pull it all apart in the halftime show up next. Welcome back to Sunday Hoops and the Hungry Jacks NBL. Half time at Kudos Bank Arena. The Sydney Kings leading the Brisbane Bullets 39-35. They outscored them by 22-15 in that second quarter and started to get things going offensively, which is where they've been winning so many games in recent
times. Right. If you're a Brisbane fan, you'd like the fact that you've kept Jalen Adams and DJ Vucinovic relatively quiet, only 6 points between the two of them on one of nine shooting. So that's a positive. But as the game went on, the tempo started to pick up. They were able, Sydney about to get their 2 feet in the paint, score around the rim. And then for the Brisbane Bullets, you're just looking at them saying, well, Franks is okay, but as we've seen, when Patterson is not scoring, you start to question, well, where are your points going to come from? And they can do it by committee and share it around, but somehow or other, they've got to find a way to get Lamar Patterson going. He's 1 of 5 from the field. And if they're going to give themselves the chance to score enough points to win this one. Then we look at the top scorers, and Swakala Bullock, he's been a revelation, really. Yeah. Now, he's not going to set the world on fire, but when you consider where he started the season from to where he's at right now, coming on as a full roster player, he has been fantastic. Shooting percentages, well, they speak for themselves. The Sydney Kings, that they started to turn things around after they were 1 of 9, I think, at the start of the game, and they eventually got it going, and contrasting that to what's happening with Brisbane. And when you look at the numbers and the closeness of the game, it's just really who can put the ball in the hole. And Sydney are just doing it slightly better than Brisbane at this point in time.
Fifth on the table, so not jumping ahead, but holistically about the Sydney Kings, Drew, where have you got them right now? 7-7 on the season.
Well, I really like them. A lot's going to depend on what happens with Ian Clark and how he fits in. But if they can get it together and stay healthy, these imports that they've got, as Hammer mentioned right from the start, they're going to be elite. So if they can get going, Xavier Cook keeps playing at this level, there's no reason why they can't be a very serious contender to push into that top four.
Speaking of Hammer, let's get courtside to Kudos Bank Arena. Shane Heal is there. Hammer, how have you seen the opening half?
It was just a bit sloppy, wasn't it? I think from the Kings particularly, they had 10 turnovers. As Drewy mentioned, some of their better players didn't get going. But they're so dangerous. That can change in a heartbeat. All of a sudden, DJ can hit 3 or 4 threes in a quarter and blow this game open. And I think it's probably more of a concern from the Bullets. They've had half of their field goal attempts from three. So they're 5 from 18, only taken 19 inside the three. And because of that, they've only got to the free throw line 5 times. I think they need to attack a little bit more.
And where does their scoring come from, Hammer? I mentioned just before that Patterson's a big piece of that, but he's virtually been unsighted in this game from a scoring standpoint. Where does it come from?
Well, I think they've been too single-minded about Patterson. I know he had a big game a few days ago, but again, we spoke about Jason Kadee. He's coming off on-ball screens as a passer, and as a point guard, you need to turn the corner as a scorer. And once that's taken away, you get into rotations, you start delivering the ball to other people. Guys like Drimmick start to get involved. So they have to do it by committee, but you have to be aggressive and attack the paint. And for me right now, they're just settling for too many threes.
Hey, Hammer, just a question without notice. On Thursday's Sydney game, Leonard Copeland said that he thinks Xavier Cooks is a walk-up start to the next Australian team. Where have you got him in terms of national duties and, I guess, the bevy of big men that we've got at our disposal right now?
Well, I was sitting on the couch and I love Xavier Cooks, but I was yelling at Cope saying, who's he going to take out then? You know, that's the hardest thing, is that we've got so much talent now, and you see finally getting over that hump, winning the medals, so many NBA players coming through. I think Cooks will be a great international player. The problem is who he comes in for. Who do you take out of that team? And it's a great problem for Brian Gorgian to have.
It is a fantastic problem. Hammer, thank you very much. As we head to the halftime break, it's Sydney leading 39-35, and you too can play like a pro thanks to Bunnings Warehouse, who are giving you the chance to win your very own court at home. A big thanks to them. You can enter now at win.nbl.com.au/Bunnings. Tough time at Kudos Bank Arena. Just about to get underway for the third quarter. Sydney leading 39-35 earlier today. It was the Southeast Melbourne Phoenix winning 83-71 over Tasmania as we get to the analysis centre with Pete Hawley.
Well, guys, we keep talking about Brisbane Bullets needing to put Franks and Patterson in the spots to be successful. This is what the Kings do well with Xavier Cooks. This was out of a timeout where they were trying to run something to get him on the move into some sort of on-ball screen or handoff. They realise, OK, Jalen Adams throws it back to Sean Bruce. Now, Xavier Cooks, he is so good when he gets the ball at the high post. So the whole idea is he's either going to flash or run into an on-ball screen with Jalen Adams if he's overplayed. See how Isaiah Moss right here is guarding Adams? Allows Xavier Cook to flash up and get this ball at around the high post on the three-point line. Everything breaks down. Easy 2 points for Vojinovic underneath. Now, this is later on in the quarter. Same thing. When Xavier Cooks gets the ball at the high post, good things happen. Good awareness again from Sean Bruce. Just test in transition. There's nothing there. Okay, now let's get something set up right here. Xavier Cooks isn't even really ready for the ball, but Sean Bruce is looking, okay, I'm going to get the ball to Xavier Cooks there. What it's going to mean is Jalen Adams can get a running start on a handoff, get downhill, or you, as good as Xavier Cooks is, you're going to fake that handoff, they're going to both bite, and then he's going to have a crack at what would have been, still is, a very nice Instagram moment.
No, I think you've got to make it to be an Instagram moment. That's just a very athletic move that didn't happen, I would have thought. Jackie boy?
What didn't happen? You're all for the Instagram moment, eh?
I love it.
Yeah.
Love it. Oh, gee, that's a sloppy start.
That's not an Instagram moment.
No, when you're trying to get things going, another turnover. And really an unforced one.
Bullets, 5 wins, 7 losses for the season. Sydney, 7 wins and 7 losses, but they've played a lot of games at home already. This is their 10th, as Drew said earlier.
Huge game for both these teams in the context of the season. And
Adams with one on the shot clock.
That's not what you want. You want 1 of 8 from the field before that. Have to launch one on the shot clock, heavily contested from deep. That's never nice because deep down, you're just praying that goes in. Now it goes to 1 of 9.
You don't mind launching it if your feet are set and you've got a reasonable look at it, but when you've got to throw up the prayer
at 1 of 8,
get to answer when you get one of, when you're at 1 of 8 is never pleasant.
Good crowd in Kudos Bank Arena. Look at deep. Up around pass for Krebs. Has to send it back out again. Late in the clock, Brisbane. Krebs forced into a tough deep two.
This has been the issue with the Bullets in that second quarter, is so much is just east to west, as in around the three-point line. Nobody's really exploring where are the options to score. That play, Robert Franks touched the ball once, and all it was to give the ball back to Jason Kadee, and him and Lamar Patterson sat on the other side, did nothing. And in the end, the Kings ended up getting what they wanted, but couldn't come up with a defensive rebound, and Tanner Krebs knocks it down.
Second three of the game for the Tasmanian. Swaka Lebulic. Blue pass, Krebs went with the left hand. There's Cooks over the top. Just pure athleticism.
This is hustle, determination and commitment to go after the ball. It's his 7th rebound, 3rd offensive. He's somewhat unassuming the way in which he just accumulates these boards. And Patterson getting himself going.
Well, Daisy, we highlighted in the first half with Xavier Cooks. You've got to do your work early. If that shot goes up from the Sydney Kings, it's not Xavier Cooks. You've got to find his body and just throw him as far away from the keyway as possible, because if the ball is up for dispute and you don't have a body on him, he's going to go up and snatch it.
Mark Patterson, 5 points at halftime. Involves Kadee. Just hasn't been able to get himself going from outside. That's 0 from 5 today. Martin, he's short. Bullets get the ball back. One more game in round 11 to come tomorrow night. The Cairns Taipans will play host to the New Zealand Breakers. Hard to the basket. Here's Patterson for 2.
We were talking about Hulls what before, but that's, I think, more the thing that you're referring to. Get it to your main guys and you don't mind him going through the process, but the process to get to that destination needs to be relevant. If you're just going to whip it around and with really no intent. The defense doesn't have to react. And you might as well just go to it first time down the floor.
And there's no need to think that, okay, Lamar Patterson and Robert Franks have to shoot the ball every time. But that possession I highlighted about a minute ago, they can't just sit in the corner. They have to be involved in the offense, whether that is making a play or just testing the waters. You just can't have your two main guys sit aside and on the other side of the wing.
No Nathan Sobey again today for Brisbane. Out with a knee issue. Fingers crossed for the Bullets fans that I think he should be right for next Saturday against the Phoenix.
And what it does do well, we've seen it now, is it's put the ball in Lamar Patterson's hands a lot. He's got 7 points, 4 rebounds, 5 assists.
Four of those points coming the last, and just this quarter, to make that 7 of those points, and he's a little upset that there was no and one on that three ball.
I think he might have a case, Daisy. Good defense, good hands from Harrison. James Duncan is screaming there, saying to stay down. And there you go. Mike Nolan just saying you moved your legs. But again, we saw it in the last game. Just stopping on a dime when you know the defense is trying to fight so hard over the screen. A lot of the time, they're not prepared to stop with you, and they're going to make some contact.
Kadeed breaks the duck. His first knockdown from outside. Brisbane have scored the last 10 points.
Now 5, you can't just bump him.
Thanks, Kalen. Not happy with that call.
Hey! It's just a drop of the shoulder, James.
They've started this third quarter. Brisbane really, really well.
My word, they have. After a really poor first possession, they've come out and looked sharp. And ball going in the hole, and just the intensity of the Sydney Kings defense has just gone off the ball a little bit.
This is one of those nights for Jalen Adams. Did all the hard work, just missed a layup in the end. We'll see how he created that space at the top of the three. We've seen him knock that down at a high rate this season so far, but his old four didn't even want to attempt it. But it got to a good spot and had the layup. He didn't make that 9 times out of 10. When it's not your night right now, just rolls out.
Well, how quickly it's turned. It's 13-2 in this quarter.
Yep.
For the Brisbane Bullets.
Lamar Patterson coming out of the game.
They're on a run and they've taken out Lamar Patterson and hit that three ball and made a couple of plays.
I don't understand why.
Cool. I'm with you. It's good. Xavier Cooks once again. Right now, your offense is ticking over. Imagine in part two, Lamar Patterson. Whether he's trying to get other people open or just the defense of the Kings trying to keep the ball out of his hands and opens things up for other people.
Now we've got to give guys rest. You know, with someone like Lamar, maybe you're concerned about rest. Now, I don't, you know, my views on that. But perhaps with him and where he's at right now and the game the other day, maybe there's something in it. But when you've got your guy and he's just come out and got 7 points in 4 minutes, it seems odd that you'd be, who knows, there might be some issues that we're not aware of.
Oh, there's Ian Clark, and that's going to be such a big piece for them going forward. Just a great signing. Great signing for the league, especially for the Kings. But again, as Gazy alluded to, it's going to take some juggling.
Yeah.
And a lot of it, you want, that's why the preseason's there. You try and figure out the role clarity, who goes where, who's playing with what unit the best. And Sydney Kings don't really have a lot of time to figure that out.
No.
They're going to have to do that on the fly, and it's not always easy to do, especially when you've got a lot of different guards trying to put in different pieces. So Chase Buford will have his hands full, but luckily you've got a very experienced player in Ian Clark to come in.
I will say that sometimes, you're right, most of the time it's not, but it certainly was easy for Bryce Cotton when he came in and fitted in nicely in a team that was in a not too dissimilar situation to what the Sydney Kings are in right now.
Oh. Look, Wiley Bale's on the sideline there. It's a turnover. Came up with Angus Glover to check into the game, but Chase Buford put his hand down his chest there. No, not you. Not yet.
Sit down, young blood.
Sat him down.
Hook, got the hook.
The hook's never nice.
5 minutes to play in the third quarter. Franks goes to work on Martin. Went up with the left hand.
And what are your
It'll be a Sydney ball. We get baseline, get courtside, I should say. It'll be a baseline ball. Hammett would have heard what the boys were just talking about there with the guard rotation when Ian Clark comes into this team.
Well, what a problem it is for Coach Chase Buford to have is the amount of talent that he's got to be able to choose from. But let's not forget that he is replacing an import that the Kings have only had for a couple of games. So I think he slots in nicely. I think it's going to take a bit of time, though. It's been 10 months since he's played. They said he had a bit of a run around yesterday and he was pretty tired pretty quickly. So they'll give him time. And I think they just have to be ready come playoff time, because I think this really is a playoff team. And once you get there, it's just so even across the NBL and who's got momentum at the right time.
Yeah, they don't have a lot of time. I mean, they've ducked and weaved to this point, what, four out of the last five. So things are going along nicely. This game, for that very reason, becomes all that more important. It's a home game, a game that you expected to win.
It's going to be one that you can see Jalen Adams' role will change a little bit. It might open things up. That's going to be an and one. Good finish there from Jarrell Martin. Everyone's roles will change ever so slightly. But a lot of it, as we said, it's going to be done on the fly during games. Okay, maybe this lineup doesn't work. Let's throw out this one. And all while trying to figure that out, you've got to make sure you're still getting those wins. So, yeah, he's also, as Hammer said, it's a good problem to have, to have all these pieces and you throw different pieces out there. But Hammer also mentioned Vasiljevic is a key piece. Shooting ability, he hasn't scored in 18 minutes tonight. You don't want him to lose confidence thinking, okay, these other guys are going to come in, have the ball in their hands more. So, I don't know, Hammer, they've still got to get shots for a guy like Vasiljevic.
Tamari Wigness back into the game. We've seen him for a couple of minutes so far today. Patterson backs in on Glover. You go back down to him. Shot clock at five. Couldn't convert off the window. Adams for three. Yes!
That will feel very good for Jalen Adams. Just 2 of 11 from the field. Finally sees one go down and timeout from James Duncan, because right now you have to make sure you know where Jalen Adams is. Doesn't take a whole lot for him to start feeling good.
And how quickly it can turn. 6 points up and then back-to-back three-point plays. One the old-fashioned way and one this one here from the corner three ball. And within the space of 30 seconds, a six-point lead is evaporated. And James Duncan wants to have a chat about it.
Scores tied away at 49. Mini six-point run here for the Kings, as Drewy said. He's got them back. It's a level pegging. And you too can play like a pro with thanks to our great mates at Bunnings Warehouse.
I only worked on shooting, which is why that's really all I can do.
I had a basketball hoop and a little trampoline. I used to play back there for hours with my brother and get beat up a lot, but it was a lot of fun in the meantime.
My dad built one, so I had a little bit of like a half court going on, and that made my life the best, so I could never complain as a kid.
That was kind of like our sanctuary, our getaway from everything.
You can get yourself involved. win.nbl.com.au/Bunnings. What was the home hoop set up like in the Hooley residence?
Like growing up on a farm with nothing but cattle around, there wasn't a whole lot. The hoop in the middle of the grass. Ball doesn't bounce too well out there.
Right. Drewy, we know where you
Casey had a first
grew up. Yeah, you had a stadium.
Court, stadium out the back.
Nine. Loose ball on the ground. And
we spoke a little bit about just before when Lamar Patterson came out when he was on a roll. And now Robert Franks has come out. And I think, you know, Nathan Sobey, got to try and find a way that we have both of them out there as long as possible, but no time, we saw it against Adelaide, no time when they're both off the floor. Man, they're just too important to the team. The only two players in double figures for the Bullets, but especially when Lamar Patterson was rolling the way he was, I guess, unless he's asked for the sub, you want to keep him out there.
Well, the thing is they both were only off for a minute and a half, and if you're doing it for rest, as Adams comes down and tries to knock down the three, if you're doing it for rest, how much rest are you really getting in 1 minute?
You might need to pull up Daisy's average minutes played, because he's hot on this topic.
No, I'm just, not at all. I understand that you're looking, could be for rotations, but if it's, if it is for rest, it's almost like a timeout you've had, I suppose, and maybe those little bits and pieces help out in the end of the day.
Glover downhill. Nice take. Draws a foul on Patterson.
Well, he's a good take from Angus Glover. We know his athleticism and saw the gap between Lamar Patterson. Got the running start, which is always tough to guard. Unless you're down in your stance, ready to slide. And really, sometimes you have to take a 50-50 punt on which way it's going to go. Lamar Patterson was out of his stance just thinking the ball was going to be reversed. And Angus Glover, with his athleticism, coming downhill. You're stuck in the mud. You're going to have to do nothing but foul. And he's going to sit down right now after that.
One. His second. Glover makes both. They've scored the last 8 points in the game. Kings lead 51-49. They're knocking on the door of the top four. A win today would certainly help their cause as they try and mount towards a playoffs run. Frank's feet set for three.
That's what Robert Franks does. He just made the space away. Jason Kadee rejecting the screen, but doing a good enough job to make sure that Xavier Cooks was worried about the driving lane. Just enough time for Robert Franks to get away the free ball.
13 points on 5 of 9 shooting to go with 6 rebounds for Franks.
Hold his arm. Two. Thanks, Anthony.
Jason Kadee, the mismatch was there and just grabbed his arm. That's what the call for. You heard the officials giving an explanation.
Two shots, guys. Here we go. Two shots.
Wiley Bales back in.
With this Sydney team, though, what you've seen when they can get out and run, how potent they can be. Now, it's just for them, it's trying to create more opportunities for that to happen. But when they can push it down the floor, they're pretty potent and with a variety of different options. I think they're still trying to figure out what happens when they're in the half court and how they prioritise certain things.
Well, you look around the league and no other team really has the opportunity to have either your big men grab the rebound and push the ball themselves without having to give it to a guard, because Darrell Martin will take it. He'll bring it up himself off a rebound, and we know Xavier Cooks, that's where he's arguably at his best.
He one of seven from outside. Glover. As Vodanovic steps into the three. And he's had some troubles this year. Only 18%.
Vodanovic was going to let that fly from as soon as it got over half court. He had his hands ready. As soon as that ball got to him from wherever it came from, he was going to launch that.
And Franks, top of the key. It's good.
He's feeling it right now. He's Bullets fan in enemy territory. Needs to be up and about when you see Franks knocking him down like he is here this afternoon. 16 points to Franks.
Hold, Rubik.
Now this is one where Robert Franks has hit a couple threes, so Xavier Cooks is going to take another step towards him to be a bit worried about where Robert Franks is on the three-point line. So can Jason Kadee get some sort of ball screen action where if it's a big diving or whoever it is, knowing there's not going to be a help on the roller. Yeah, the foul called. Well, Donovan and Anthony Jones just making sure he didn't get the practice in. Whether that's a key ball of Franks in the corner on the wing, and you've got Jason Kadee coming off a side ball screen, that way Xavier Cooks has to be aware of where Franks is and where the roller is. So might not be able to get a tag. So you might get an easy layup. Everyone right now is worried about where Franks is.
When you think about adjustments with your personnel, this season, Anthony Drivic is one that, with the personnel around him, hasn't had the same types of opportunities he's had previously. Deng Deng was wide open, but that, to me, is not a great shot.
King's looking to take the lead back. Vasiljevic, head down. Still remains scoreless. Only his third field goal attempt this afternoon as well. Kadee at the other end. Doesn't get it to go.
14.
He's having a tough time from the field. He's 2 of 9, but that's the sort of play that we've been talking about, the decision making, the way in which he can use an on ball, that time just a straight line drive. When you talk about your two guys, your two primary guys that you play through, having both of them on the bench. Now, I know fouls can be an issue, but he's just got two. And
normally you see that, you'd be okay with that if maybe Vasiljevic has got going in a game. And then you've got Sean Bruce running the one, who's an excellent pass first point guard. But okay, let's run a couple of things to Vasiljevic. He's yet to score. So Xavier Cooks is not someone you're just going to throw the ball to and say, go one-on-one every single time. So I'm with you, Drury. Just the way the game kind of played out, it's...
Both those two only had the two personal fouls each, so it's not like they're in foul trouble. And just trying to get, maybe get some rest to 4-3-quarter time. DJ still can't find that elusive three.
I'm staring both at you. The ball's on this side. If it came to this side, you were going to get a foul for you.
So on my roll, what did you see?
Listen, ball went to the other side. Thank you.
Well, I thought it was going to be a foul from coming over the top. But I think the foul was actually on the rebound, I assume.
Thank you.
Looked like Bales was coming over the top. Something must have happened prior to that.
So last possession of the quarter will be with the Kings. Vasiljevic, scoreless today, threw it up there. Brisbane in front at three-quarter time. On the road, searching for a really, really crucial victory in their season. They're in a good spot with a quarter to play. We'll come back and see how it all ends up after this on Sunday Hoops. Three-quarter time at Kudos Bank Arena. Here's the DoorDash Kids Dash. They race to see who's going to be crowned today's DoorDash hero and win a $100 DoorDash voucher.
Gee whiz, Kobe Bryant should be protesting. She might have just taken the wrong line.
That's a bit of a Stephen Bowman.
Do you reckon she'll send that up to the stewards? They might have to. Post-race chat about that.
Well behind. I'm not sure how many gears those scooters have.
Sam McKinnon. Oh, there's an Olympian. Australian Olympian.
And a man who played above the rim.
One of the had the most hellacious dunks in NBL history against the Newcastle Falcons, I reckon it was. I think it was his rookie. It might have been his second year. If you have a chance, hopefully, it's probably out there on YouTube, but it was spectacular. And won a title with the Brisbane Bulls, MVP as well, as if you don't mind.
All-time greats.
Now doing a very good job as the GM.
No, right. MVP.
I'm going to have to try and find that dunk, because once he goes back to all time, I just can't get Clark out of my head. A good take from Tony Krebs.
It's up there. It's not saying that it's one of them. There's a big, big catalogue.
As a youngster growing up, trust me, Sam McKinnon was huge. Mm. He was a very, very popular player.
Everyone's huge compared to you, Jack.
That's exactly right.
You mean huge in stature. Or status, not in stature.
Status, yeah.
Yes, that's right.
Oh, that's good awareness there.
I'm sure the drive-by was necessary.
Wow. 5-2 with a stretch.
Franks, nice finish.
Good offense. Little on-ball, good start. When you're looking just to steady the nerves and put some heat and pressure on the Sydney Kings, this is perfect start for the Brisbane Bullets.
61-54, early stages in the fourth quarter. Timeout called, an early one by Chase Buford.
Early one. I think it's needed too. You can just see the momentum going their way. You want to try and nip that in the bud as early as you possibly can. And clearly by the reactions in that timeout, he's very upset with the start that they've had, making some calls, quick calls, and I think important calls. Getting Jarrell Martin back in.
Here we go.
Just gone a minute in the last quarter. Chase Buford's already seen enough that they know how important this game is. Both teams, we spoke about its importance coming in.
It's a miss. Let's have a look at who got it right. Wow, that guy, there's our winner, I think, $50. Thanks to Chemist Warehouse, you've done it. Buy some vitamins.
And a big thanks to Latrobe Financial, who are stumping up the cash, $100,000 to be precise. If you think that you've got the goods to nail one from full court, then this is the competition for you. Details are on your screen. How do the Kings respond out of this timeout?
Well, it's no surprise. Both Martin and Adams are back into this ballgame. I know Adams hasn't been on fire as his usual self, but you still need to have him out there as a playmaker. Good pass from Xavier Cook.
Jeez.
I don't have to see that from Vasiljevic. But again, we said it at the end of the third quarter. You had both Munn and Adams sitting down, and Brisbane went on a little run. And you start the fourth quarter with them on the bench, and Brisbane continued their run. So it's the kind of gamble, I guess, you go with. We need to get some rest into our superstars to finish out the game as strong as possible.
Bit of a contrast to their... That's a sloppy turnover. Their last three games at home, Sydney, they scored 97, 96, and 84.
Yeah, they've been good. They've been good in putting points on the board. And today, they've struggled. 35% from the field. And it's the three ball that's really hurt them. 5 of 23 at 21% from the three-point line. And almost half their shots coming from the three-point line.
That game they lost to the Jack Jumpers down in Tassie, we were highlighting the supporting cast really not stepping up behind. Jalen Adams had to force a lot. Xavier Cooks was outstanding, but didn't get a whole lot of shots, and Jarrell Martin did his thing. No one else had more than one field goal in that game, and that was something we were always looking at. Good take there. Sakala Bullock has the three field goals bails too, but really, no one has taken any pressure off anybody. It's Jalen Adams, 3 of 14. Trying to get something to happen here.
Patterson blocked. Vasiljevic got upstairs and got a piece of it. Martin to the other end, scores. Kings have got it back to a three-point game.
Well, he's having a good time.
He is in good response out of the timeout. Early timeout, they did have all three, so it was easy to burn one when they came out with that slow start. But they bring their two jets back in, and things start to look a whole lot different on the offensive end.
Not that time for Anthony Drimmick. The Kings look their best when they play up tempo. Glover, big knockdown for the Kings, tied at 61.
Huge, and Glover, he's not afraid of the moment. Even that game, their last game against Finns, scores get back to three. The game's a ball game. Knocks down a three in the corner, and that right there is a huge one.
Let's get courtside to Shane Hill.
Master stroke from Chase Buford. His team was struggling to score, so he's gone with Jarrell Martin, a point guard, and 3-2 men. It's a small ball at its best, and they've gone on a 7-0 run.
We saw this lineup in the first half as well. And it's how I think Brisbane react, and they haven't reacted well, but how do they punish that? How do they use their size? And Patterson on the box is the obvious one, but sometimes it's easier said than done to get him in those situations.
That's going to be an offensive foul. Good take from Anthony Drimmick. And Jarrell Martin in that one right there. He just takes a little bit of a step towards the hoop. He's going to have a layup. Just kind of got stuck in the no man's land and watching Swakopoulos Bullock. He did that really well, Swakopoulos Bullock, to get Robert Franks in the air and attack. And then when Anthony Drimmick stepped up, if Jarrell Martin takes a couple steps towards the hoop, he's going to have a layup.
There is Jarrell Martin, 15 points, 6 rebounds. Leading scorer in the game is Franks with 18 for Brisbane. Kadee. He's been held through the foul eventually.
Jason Kadee was appealing for an unsportsmanlike. Thought his jersey, it looked like he was indicating he thought his jersey was pulled, which technically we've seen that called
this season. Xavier Cooks a couple of weeks ago. Yeah.
And it changed the game.
Frank's got Cooks up in the air.
That's going to dodge a bullet because Robert Franks fumbled that ball and Xavier Cooks went flying. There was no shot fake. There was nothing. He's been trying to run him off the three-point line. He had a good look after that. Kick three of him tonight.
Martin lost it. Still time for the Kings. Glover was there for a while. That doesn't drop.
Xavier Cooks, double-double. First man this season to have 8 double-doubles on the season.
Jarrell Martin not too far away as well. He's had 7 across the year. Patterson into the paint. Cooks blocks the shot. Here goes Glover. Stripped by Drimmick.
Angus Glover not happy. There's a lot of contact there.
Great hustle, get back and contest. A swipe at the ball and gets the stop. Let's have a look at the replay. Here it is here, and oh,
absolutely.
Looked like there was a bit of arm in that.
Oh, that and leg. Cleaned up his legs as well, but in the end, it's still King's ball. Saw Anthony Drimmick have a little bit of a giggle.
Might have got away with one.
Foul count's not always an indication of what's going on, but it is 20-9 in favour of the Kings. That's 20 fouls to the Bullets to 9. It was 20-6.
Two snap!
No, because he just is missing everything. He needs some help.
Chase Buford already has a technical foul. Bullets have won just one of their last 5. This would be a massive scalp for them on the road. Hey, on, Patterson, no foul call. And Cooks trying to get busy. Back out for Bruce. He finds Cooks all alone.
Well, that's just great job from both players. But again, Xavier Cooks is just going to work his way into the right spot. Sean Bruce, the pass first point guard. Looked like he had Lamar Patterson beaten. Instead of just throwing something up, running away from the hoop, just looks for the big fella Xavier Cooks, who's in the right spot. He's not missing that. And just runs into the back of Jason Kadee. And just a little accidental bump.
That was accidental. Jason Kadee had his back to him then, so nothing too serious.
Third meeting of the season. The home team has won both so far. Deng Deng lost it. And the Kings playing to take the lead. Adams puts it behind the back on Moss. He gives it up. And Deng Deng, who turned it over initially, gets it back for Brisbane.
It's been one of those nights for Jalen Adams. 6 turnovers. Only got 3 assists. I'm not used to seeing that since he's been healthy. 11 points, 3 of 14.
Good pass, Kadi.
And Deng Deng went up. Cooks went with him.
Just can't understand why at this stage of the game Franks is on the bench. Well, there you go. He comes in, but...
He's got 18 points. He's been 18 points, 9 rebounds. Everywhere when the Bullets have needed him.
Adams almost gave it up. Glover to Bruce with 3 on the clock. 6 of 26 from outside today, Sydney.
That's Jalen Adams again. Just not that extra gear to really get past everybody and get those easy ones. A lot of that would be from the shoulders up. And offensive foul there on Deng Deng.
Gee, these moments, some of the decisions that have been made right across the board, it's Deng Deng upset with himself.
Gotcha.
Critical plays. You just don't put yourself in a situation where you're coming to set that screen. You don't want to just stand there. If you can't set an effective screen for whatever reason, just in the context of the game and where we're at, it's, you don't need to do that.
We've seen that all night from Xavier Cooks. 7 of 12, 15 points, 12 rebounds, but right around there, got that little floater, whether it's off 1 foot, 2 foot, doesn't matter.
Sydney back in front, looking to make it win number 7 on their home floor this season. Harrison, big move, we're back to level pegging. It's taken him until now to score his first points in the game. Martin thought that he was fouled.
He's got a very strong case. Looked like he was a bit in that. And in the end, stop for the Bullets.
We'll get back to it. New balls, please.
Yeah, a little ISO play for Martin. He gets to the rim. And the Kings were wanting a foul. Franks comes back in.
And now time to go to work.
Final 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Patterson. It was huge for them in their win on Friday. That's another big moment.
We had the 3. He created the separation, but just that strength to dribble to his preferred spot inside the paint and comes up with the 2.
And Adams responds. Quick score. 67 each.
Well, I know it's been a tough night for Jalen Adams, but a minute and a half to go. Everybody will forget that if you do whatever you can to get the win here for the Sydney Kings.
Drivick turns the corner. It goes.
I'm not sure we've had 3 possessions in a row where there have been buckets the entire game.
It's been a tough afternoon for both teams. Adams.
Great call. Number 1, holding. Face, purple ball.
Can't make it count. You heard the explanation there. A late call. Third foul on Robert Franks.
Martin got that inside position for the O boards. And given the foul situation, it's not a bad foul. Because if Martin catches that, it's straight up easy putback.
Kings to inbound. 14 on the shot clock. That will be a foul on Drimmick.
3 hits. Changing the ball, changing the ball.
Deng Deng looked like he had a few words to say.
Yeah.
Just to give him a reminder of what's going on. There's the foul, there's the continuation, and there's the... Just make sure that...
Well, it goes both ways. I know the whistle is not going to count, but just in case they, for some reason, certain plays, there's a continuation. If he's going to continue just to throw it up there, then I think Drimmick's got the right to just say no. Stay out of that. So it goes both ways.
Neither team has led by more than 7 today. It's one of the closest games we've had all season here in the Hungry Jacks NBL. right from the opening tip. Shot clock at three. Adams from deep. Martin the monster on the offensive glass. Brisbane get possession back.
And again, we're going to have another ball change. So right now, anytime the ball goes to Jarrell Martin, he's putting it to his body.
Straight up. The fans don't like it, but it looked like there was just straight up hands in the air. And Martin upset that he doesn't get the call. Good effort on the glass to go get it.
I was referring to have three wet ball changes because Jarrell Martin drenched in sweat and holding that ball under there. And basically he tried to dribble and says, can't do anything with this. But I was with you, that looked like a lot of verticality.
It is. This is a big play for the Brisbane Bullets. They call a timeout. And who do you go to? This is the one out to me. You're going to try and look to this man on the screen, Robert Franks. He's been really good this afternoon, patiently going about it, not forcing the issue, taking what's given to him. And he's been really efficient. 7 of 13 from the field, 3 of 8 from the three-point line. And he's got 18 points and the 9 raw boards. So he's been really good in the plus-minuses. One of the reasons why Halls and I were thinking, well, why is he on the bench? The plus-minus is he is plus 17.
Well, right now, talking about getting him involved, whatever it's like, if you can get something with a ball screen where Lamar Patterson being the decision-maker, but have Robert Franks setting that ball screen. So Xavier Cook has been the one guarding Robert Franks, and Lamar Patterson, whoever's guarding him, depends what they want to do. Are they going to switch it? If they switch it, then you've got Robert Franks potentially with a smaller guard on him. You can roll into a spot where he's comfortable, rise up and shoot the ball. And if they get caught up on it, Lamar Patterson's going to make a play. So that's something they can really try and look at. You've still got Drimmick and Kadee. We know they've both struggled to shoot the ball as of late. But here we go. So Lamar Patterson bringing the ball up. And they try and get that ball screen with Robert Franks or something in the action. And there we go.
Both teams have fouls to give. Patterson, their go-to man late in the game.
He had Franks too on the pass back.
That's what we called for, that ball screen.
Sydney down two. Cook's dribbling into the paint. No foul call.
You're going to have to foul now.
Oh, that almost gave it up.
That's almost unsportsmanlike.
I'm saying there's a lot of contact down there, but the referee's saying we can't see through 5 people. Everybody is in here.
From that angle, it's hard to tell. It looked pretty clean. Drew McCann on the ball. No foul there.
Timeout. 17 seconds left. Brisbane lead by two.
Well, I don't think they need to do much more than what they did the last time. Now, clearly, they're going to just be extending the defense, and I suspect that they're not going to advance it here. So who called that timeout? Was it Brisbane that called that or Sydney called that? If they, either way, they'll be looking to keep the ball in the backcourt and to give them more space to inbound it. You've got to get it over the halfway line, and then it comes down to a free throw competition, because I think Sydney are going to have to foul.
Yep.
If not, you just run out the clock, and I think you've got to give yourself as much time as possible in order to get a good shot down the other end. Hope that they miss a free throw. They're in the bonus, so any other foul from now is going to send Brisbane to the free throw line.
They're not a great free throw shooting team, Brisbane. Only 71% across the season. Seventh in the competition in that stat.
I only have three guys go to the line tonight, and all three have missed at least one.
And normally you're saying we'll get it to Patterson, but his free throw shooting this season has not been in the mid-60s, 67%. So he would be a good option. So
Franks is not much better, Drew, at 64%.
No. Looks like they're having Patterson inbounded.
86th meeting between these two teams. We've only gone to overtime once. That was December 1990.
Oh, no.
Brisbane give it up. Glover for three. He's short. Offensive rebound by Adams.
Well, this is going to be reviewed, so this looks like it could very well be off Jalen Adams, but my goodness.
Krebs just missed the pass. Patterson threw it to him. He went straight through his hands. Maybe they didn't wipe the sweat off the ball, or maybe the moment just got the better of Krebs. But it gave Sydney two really good looks. Glover with the three ball. Not a bad shot in the context. Wide open. He's just hit one, so a little while ago.
It's one that if he hits, it's big time, but I still think they maybe could have got something else. Xavier Cooks just put the brakes on, really tried to slow it down rather than getting downhill.
There it is, wide open. Good find by Cooks.
They're going to review this to see if it was out on him.
Ooh. I don't think Patterson hit it.
Well, I think that Patterson hit the back of Jalen Adams' hand. So it's...
Hands are part of the ball.
That's exactly right. So I think Jalen Adams...
And that follow-through...
It's going to be hard to overturn. I mean, it is King's ball. I would think that this is going to be...
overturned.
Absolutely.
Let's have a look here.
And unless they deem that is Patterson pushing the ball out, because both their hands are going that way, but...
His hand was in front, though.
The replay center will be going...
And just that frame by frame, little follow-through.
We don't get to see all that. But, my goodness, just a drop.
Well, now if you do have it, I think you, if you're going to do it, you call a timeout and you advance the ball and get it down the other end. If they do come up with it and the call is overruled.
I'm not sure the Bullets have a timeout in the bank.
Oh, they're done?
Yeah, they're staying with them. So no conclusive evidence, and it's going to be Sydney ball.
Brisbane have not won in Sydney since December 2017. They lead by two, but the home team in possession. Jalen Adams has had a tough day. Gets to the basket. Oh, my goodness, Jalen Adams. What a play.
Oh.
Points count. One to come.
What? Well, they were looking and hoping for a three ball. This is not the fashion you thought you were going to get it. With just an explosion at the rim.
Crazy. We've seen dunk of the year. That's got to be up there.
Well, when it comes to the occasion and the moment and what it means for the game and possibly the season, there has been none better.
That is remarkable.
No fouls.
No timeouts for the Bullets.
You still need to make this because 3 seconds is probably just a half a second too long.
He misses. Loose ball. Sydney get it back and win the game.
Are you kidding me?
Are you?
Jalen Adams is worth every dollar that they're paying him.
What is happening? How does that happen on an offensive rebound on a free throw?
On a free throw in the most important play of the game. Somehow or other, the Sydney Kings come up with it with the easiest two of the game for Jarrell Martin.
How does that happen?
By any means necessary.
We spoke about it. Jalen Adams, one of his worst games, no doubt about it, but who cares? In the last 90 seconds, nobody cares, but with a dunk of the year, doesn't get the free throw, but how does that happen on a free throw? We talk about how important it is. So here it is. This is dunk of the year. Mark your books. That is disgusting for the game.
That is, have a look at this.
Oh, my.
That is just athleticism.
And then this, just everybody falling asleep, thinking we're going to come up with the ball.
It was almost like Brisbane thought, oh, well, this is going to go in, and we're going to figure out what we're going to do next.
Hey, dogs on three. One, two, three. Let's
see. Ultimate get out of jail. The missed catch is going to go down as a big play, but none bigger than what we just saw from Adams.
Still in shock of what's gone on in the last 30 seconds.
Bulls, like you said, 5 of 19 from the field, 1 of 7 from threes, 6 turnovers, but not a great one, but a heroic one for Adams.
That is one of the most outstanding plays we'll see all season, and we've seen some incredible plays.
Hammer's got the man of the moment.
I certainly do. Mate, you were 4 for 18 with 6 seconds left. He decided to take the ball to the basket and throw down one of the best dunks we've seen in the season. Take us through it.
I mean, Rail set a good screen. I knew they were switching, so I really didn't want to get to the switch, so I refused the screen. Lane opened up, and my legs felt good.
You got the offensive rebound. You missed the free throw and another beautiful pass to be able to win that game. A lot of emotion out here tonight. It means a lot. Got a new import coming in. Great things are happening.
Yeah, for sure. I think we're moving in the right direction tonight. We could have done a lot better on the offensive end, especially myself. But I just wanted the team to win, and we did a great job pulling it up.
Well, it wasn't pretty for a big part of the game. But good teams find a way to be able to claw their way back and make big plays at the right time.
Absolutely. And I credit the defense. We really picked it up early in the fourth quarter. Kind of changed the pace of the game. They were running away with it a little bit. And I'm just glad we was able to come out with a win, man. We needed this.
Fantastic finish to the game, mate. Well done. Congrats.
Thank you.
Just an incredible final quarter. Jalen Adams had his struggles across the day, but had a big involvement. None bigger, though, than the footlocker player of the game, Xavier Cook.
Well, I'm still in a little bit of shock of what I saw, because Brisbane, they're going to lose a lot of sleep over this one. I'm still trying to figure out how they lost that game, but they found a way to do it, notwithstanding the brilliance, but, gee, there was a lot of self-inflicted wounds. But Xavier Cook's just steady. As he said, he just accumulates the way the game unfolds. He's in the right place at the right time. He understands the game. 15 points, 13 rebounds, and really steady, and that calming influence that he has out on the court. There you see the numbers, and just hustle plays and pulls. Oh.
Mate, I'm in shock too. I'm speechless. I am without words. One, the dunk, obviously. Xavier Cooks was terrific. Make no mistake about that. But how you have that breakdown on a free throw is important as that. I'm shocked.
We're going to come back and try and work out what just happened. Sydney winners by 2 at Kudos Bank Arena. What a remarkable finish to Sunday Hoops. The Sydney Kings winning 71-69. That for a game for a large period of the fourth quarter, the Brisbane Bullets had in control.
Well, it wasn't a great game, but it was a spectacular finish. And to Brisbane's credit, they found a way to put themselves in a winnable position and then just completely messed it up. Some great action, end-to-end action. The Sydney Kings looked good when they were getting out and running. Neither team shot the ball that well. Sydney Kings win it, shooting 21% from the three-point line and only 38% from the field. And then it was just that the plays that down the stretch made the game and made it one of the more memorable games, not for the Brisbane Bullets, though. James Duncan, these are the games that you go home and you look at this and you just scratch your head and say, how did we possibly let that happen? And players in big moments. Uh-oh. Here's the dunk that gets posterises quite a few of them. And then somehow or other, they're able to come up with a missed free throw. Adam, he had the 15 points. Jarrell Martin with the 17. Frank's 18. He was great, Frank. Steady. And Patterson, and inefficient. He was 6 of 17, but he was solid with his 14 points in a game where they were struggling to find points.
Well, they had this game sewn up when you think about it. Yeah, a couple of substitutions here or there and then crucial errors, but just a couple of brain lapses at crucial moments, starting with the turnover, the drop ball, and then that free throw. We're going to have to talk about that. It's going to be a massive talking point all week.
Let's try and make sense of what's just happened. Let's try and go through this in sequential order of the last 20-odd seconds. Total madness, Hulls.
Well, it's Anthony Drewick. Just spent it before he had it, expecting a foul. They got away with this because Angus Glover missed a pretty good look, and then this one was a view. No, yeah, offensive rebound, but then this right here from Jalen Adams, that's just disgusting. And that's just a player making a play.
Filthy, as they say. Filthy.
And then this,
with a PH.
The free throw.
So Patterson has the foul on the dunk, but then what was Lamar Patterson thinking just randomly running? And that's just in the heat of the moment, your emotions get the better of you. Mm. If he just stays put, that pass is not on. But for some reason, maybe he was unaware of how much time. And to me, it was the Brisbane Bullets thinking, well, he's going to make this free throw. What's our next action? Rather than just playing the play first and seeing what happens, because they were all out of sorts once that free throw missed and they didn't box out. They did everything wrong in that last box out in that free throw situation.
Here's the Amy Ladder. For the Sydney Kings, they're still around that mark. They can't just quite get themselves into fourth spot at the moment, but gee, they're close. That's 8 wins for the season.
Well, it doesn't matter sometimes how you win as long as you get the win. And we talk about what's to come with Ian Clark. They're going to have some things to figure out, but any win is better than losing. It doesn't matter if it's ugly. They'll take that and move forward. Jalen Adams, that's what superstars do. Pretty average for 85% of the game, but when the game was there to be won, he took over, made some big plays, and none bigger. We've seen the dunks of the year, and I think that's probably going to... I thought Mitch Creek, Will McDowell White probably was up there on Smith Milner, but I think Jalen Adams just catapulted himself to the top.
On the other side of the coin, though, the Brisbane Bullets, unfortunately, are going to have to live with this one for quite some time. It's been a pretty remarkable day on Sunday Hoops. Thanks so much for joining us on behalf of Drewy Hulls, Shane Heal and our team behind the scenes. We can't wait to have your company tomorrow night for Cairns and New Zealand. Until then, stay safe and thanks for watching the Hungry Jacks NBL.
This program is brought to you by Hungry Jack's and Bunnings Trade. This program is brought to you by Hungry Jack's and Amy.
Locker room hype, get ready for the drop.
Hello, welcome. You're watching the Amy Crossover. Great to have your company on a very eventful Sunday afternoon. I'm Kath Dirk, and great to have your company. An incredible finish we've just seen. The Sydney Kings just getting the win there, of course. Crazy finish, as we say. Kane Pittman, Damon Lowry and Marley Biondolo alongside me to discuss it. Guys, I think we're all just still a bit in shock with what we've just seen.
That was awesome. Damon nearly took his own head off, jumping off the couch when Jalen Adams threw that dunk down.
I thought he had a heart attack or pulled a hammy or something.
I know, and he threw the ball at me,
hey,
too.
I reacted. I was only just saying, can Jalen get up? And he proved he could.
We were just talking about it.
Yeah, absolutely. I suppose it was that kind of finish where we thought Brisbane had just managed to close it out, sort of seemed to be on top, but things just happened in the Kings' favour and they managed to capitalise.
Well, that's it. I think that's why we reacted the way we did, because we thought Brisbane had that one in the bag. And there you go. You know, you have a turnover like that at the end. You don't box out, you know, you don't box out. That kills coaches, and they get an opportunity to get the ball, get it down to Jarrell, and finishes for the game winner. So.
Yeah. Well, speaking of Jarrell, he's standing by for us. We are going to go back to Kudos at Bank Arena. We're with him now. Jarrell, what a crazy finish. What was it like to be a part of that?
Yeah, it was amazing, man. You know, it definitely went down to the wire. Our team, we dug in there and made some big plays, got some big stops, and man, congrats to Jalen, man. That finish, that dunk, it definitely got us going.
Jarrell, Kane Pittman here. We'll talk about the dunk. Let's stick with the dunk. So from your vantage point, when you see him put the ball on the floor, at what point do you realise that he's about to go up and try and throw this thing down, and what's going through your head?
You know, I never realised that. I ain't get that point. You know, he had a play in the first half. I told him he could have dunked it. But he ended up laying it up, and you know, he definitely finished that one that time, the second opportunity.
Jarrell, Marley here, brother. First of all, great game from you. Way to get a game winner and win that one for your squad. It's halfway through the season now, and you know, you guys need to make strides, tick over in wins. You've obviously got the addition of Ian Clark being there. How excited are you to have him now in your squad?
I'm definitely excited, man. Another guy that's going to come on and, you know, give us a spark on the offense and defensive end. You know, we can't wait to have him aboard out here with us.
Jarrell, Damon here, man. Baton Rouge, what's up?
What's up, my man?
Hey, does Chase Buford, he realizes tomorrow's the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Now, what you guys doing tomorrow, and who you think gonna win?
Man, it's an early game. I'll probably just sit inside and watch it. You know, I got both Tigers on both teams, so you know, I just wanted to be a great game.
All right.
Yeah, absolutely. We might backtrack a little bit to the game we've just seen and talk a bit more generally as well about Xavier Cooks as well. His season just going from strength to strength. And another double-double today, 15 points, 13 boards. Must be great having him alongside you.
Yeah, it's great. You know, X, his motor and energy, man, it's great for us. It's something we need. You know, a guy that's going to come out and leave his all out there on the floor.
Jarrell, we'll get... stick with Jalen Adams here. So obviously he missed a few games to start the season, and he's been kind of trying to find his footing, and you've been having that partnership with him along with Xavier as well. Where do you think you guys are at in terms of finding your footing and finding your chemistry as a group?
We definitely still building right now. You know, it's the chemistry going to come together. You know, we all just starting to be together out there on the floor together. So the chemistry going to come. You know, we just got to keep building. Don't let the momentum build.
Absolutely. Well, you're tracking in the right direction. Jarrell Martin, thanks so much for your time. Enjoy the win.
Yeah, thank you all.
Way to win, brother.
Now, we touched on Ian Clark there. Obviously, their import that's just arrived. He didn't get on the call. We didn't expect him to, but he'd be pretty happy with what he saw out there today. Pretty excited about what's to come.
I expected him to.
Oh, did you?
I would have loved to have seen him out there for at least 1 minute. It's Ian
Clark.
I think
you'd hope to.
It's Ian Clark. Hey, look, I know there was a time I like to tell a quick story. Bobby Locke, ladies and gentlemen, he came to Australia, he stepped off the plane, went straight to the stadium and dropped 50 points. So, Ian Clark, NBA championship player, been all over the world. I'm sure he could have helped that team, especially DJ was 0 for Sunday. Mm. But anyway, when he does get back into the team, when he slots in, it'll be a welcome addition.
Yeah, absolutely. Some pieces to work with. Let's talk about Brisbane, because I mentioned it before that they seem to have it at the end there, and a few slip-ups just really cost them, really, you know, things that shouldn't be occurring in an NBL clash. I suppose the pressure might have just got to them a bit.
Well, I think we should be thankful that they had a couple of slip-ups at the end, because then we saw the dunk and we saw the craziness towards the end of this game. But, yeah, they will rue this, and the same thing the other night as well. I mean, they're trying to build in, but they find themselves in these tight situations late. Unfortunately, you have to figure it out down the stretch. They weren't able to. There was that the inbound play that we spoke about. Marley already pointed to not boxing out in the free throw. Mm-hmm. It's just not being locked in at the key moments. This is a game they should have won.
Yeah, so we've got the vision here of how it all transpired at the end there. Let's talk through, I suppose, what happened. It was Drimmich, I think, that dropped the ball, and then it just went down straight the other end, and then there was that questionable, Glover going for the three, and then Jalen Adams doing what he did. But that questionable moment there where it went out and it seemed to have just been Jalen throwing it straight out and then getting a tip off. Let's talk through it. What are we thinking is all just transpired here?
Well, look, I think to me it comes down to boxing out. You see there, Jason Kadee there clearly doesn't box Jalen out firstly, and then secondly, that box out on the free throw wasn't there either. So as a coach, you know, that kills you. You know what I mean? Mm. Two crucial moments where you need a box out. That's what you need to do. That's your assignment, especially late game. They didn't do that and it cost them the game. That's a tough way to lose.
Yeah, you were saying before we were coming on, it kind of sums up Brisbane as a team at the moment, doesn't it?
I feel like Brisbane is such an up-and-down team. It seems like things just don't quite go their way. I thought they would have had some momentum coming into the game after the way they had the win the other day. Thought Lamar Patterson was just starting to get into the game. Robert Franks was having a solid game. But it's just those key moments in crucial times they don't seem to be consistent at. So, and that's the difference in winning and losing. Everything is so tight in this league. You can't afford slip-ups like that, and they seem to do that too often.
Mm-hmm. We saw Lamar Patterson the other night, 32 points, I think it was, 14 today. It kind of is a little bit of an indicator of how much of a barometer he is for this side. When he's on, they're on.
Yeah, and it's a tough matchup. Xavier Cooks, we've been saying it for a while. We think he's the defensive player of the year, and he did it again tonight, and he is the guy that gets all the key matchups, whether it's going to be Mitch Creek, whether it's going to be a Lamar Patterson, those wings, Vic Law. Xavier Cooks is the guy that gets those matchups. He got the job done again today.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I suppose when we talk about Ian Clark as well, just backtracking a little bit, do you think what we've seen today, we talk about it more generally, but do you think he is a perfect fit for this side?
I think he is. To me, I do, especially with the way that Xavier and Jarrell are playing at the moment. I think if they slipped in a big there, it could have maybe thrown off that cohesion that they're now rolling with. You know, they're rolling with momentum now. I think throwing in a guard to help out Jalen, especially when DJ's having a rough day like today and not shooting the ball well, to have another guard there that can score, can be aggressive, can make plays at the rim, I think is perfect for Sydney, to be honest.
Yeah, poses as a great asset, doesn't he? All right, we do need to get to a break. We are going to go through the South East Melbourne Phoenix and the Jack Jumpers at Clash next. That one had a bit in it as well. We'll do that for you after the break.
Hello and welcome to another episode of At The Line. It has been a massive week in the NBA. Ben Simmons has finally found himself a home. Harden, is he finally going to find happiness in the city of brotherly love of Philadelphia? I don't think so, but you know what? It's the NBA and anything can happen. The man who dissects these markets better than any other is sitting right next to me, Daniel Parisi. Welcome.
Thanks, Felix. That was a hot intro, especially the city of brotherly love with James Harden. But I'm pretty set on a team in the Eastern Conference who made no moves whatsoever. That's the Miami Heat. That's my take early.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, sometimes intros are better when you've had to do them about seven times beforehand. So finally, we're here and let's roll through it. The championship market you just touched on, Philly into $7.50, was sitting around $15 not that long ago. Are you buying or selling that price?
No, at the moment, I think you just need to sit firm on the Philadelphia 76ers at $7.50. I wouldn't re-engage if you took $15 2 weeks ago. If you were buying into what Daryl Morey's saying, you know, Ben Simmons was going to eventually be traded and they brought in James Harden who can bookend that starting unit. But for me, I've said it all season long. It's the Miami Heat. They're just too supreme. They've got great role players and they understand how to play two-way basketball. So I would continue to double down on the Miami Heat.
I love it that we just forget the Golden State Warriors who have been there, done that. Everything wants what's new, outside prices. Maybe the Warriors are just going to come and roll through it and get this one done in four games, which is a real possibility. But the NBA All-Star Weekend, we love it. The All-Star Game for me has lost a bit of spice, but the skills challenges, the dunk contest, the three-point contest, still love them. And the reason I love the three-point contest this year is because Patty Mills is going to win it. I love his price, and I just reckon he's the type of guy. We grow up in Australia sitting on the shooting racks, bang, bang, bang. They don't do that as much in America. I reckon Patty Mills is a lock for the three-point contest. And Jalen Green, you got to go with the young guys for the dunk contest. I'm sticking with him. Where are you playing?
Give me the second best shooter in the NBA right now. It's Fred VanVleet shooting it at 40% on the floor from three. Combine that into Obi Toppin, who needs to do something in the NBA. We know he's got the windmill up his sleeve, so I reckon he can win the slam dunk contest.
Love it. Dunks, threes. What else do you want? Enjoy and gamble responsibly.
Yeah, wise words. Thanks to the gents from Sportsbet there. Now, we've got to go through the earlier game now, guys. The Phoenix just, well, not just edging. They did it pretty comfortably against the Jack Jumpers. 83-71, the final score. I don't like describing teams as brave, but I'm going to do it because the Jack Jumpers, they were out without Will Magnay. They're in their first season in the comp and they are really sticking with good sides, even if they're not getting the W.
They are. We spoke to Xavier Cooks yesterday. We had him on the crossover. And when we were chatting to him before we came on, he said that the Jack Jumpers are one of the hardest teams to play against because you can consistently rely on the fact they're going to play defense, they're going to play hard, and they're going to be really, really annoying. And they did that again today for three quarters against Southeast Melbourne.
They made the Phoenix work for that. They're not going to shoot themselves in the foot anymore. I think the Jack Jumpers are trending. We already see their identity now. They have a new identity. They're going to play hard. They're going to use the ball. A lot of body movement. Everything's happening. Mykal McIntosh is starting to creep up a little bit, get more involved in the offense. They were just a little bit unlucky today as far as the rebounds go because they didn't have that rim protector. They didn't have the shot blocker in there. That kind of hurt them a little bit. But, yeah, but they still pushed Phoenix and made Phoenix actually work for it.
Yeah.
I agree. As a defender, especially as a guard, you know, Damon, if you have that solid, you know, rock, that big behind you that can block shots, you can guard so much harder with confidence, knowing if you get beat, that Will's going to be there to beat that shot up. But I love Tassie. I said to these guys before, I think they're one of my favourite teams to watch in the league. They're so exciting. Their energy's great. Obviously, Coach Roth's an amazing guy as well. So, you know, they're an exciting bunch of boys to watch get out there and shoot the ball and just play free and try and win every game they go out and play.
Yeah, exactly. As you say, they're an exciting team to watch and that's what we love to see. Now, there was a little bit of excitement on the sidelines at one point. Phoenix coach in Simon Mitchell having some words with the ref. Let's take a listen.
You can challenge the foul call if you want.
No, just, challenge it.
I'm watching that.
I can. Do I challenge it?
You can challenge the foul call.
Enough. Okay.
You can challenge the foul call. What do you
want? Can I challenge an offensive foul? Next
time. You can challenge the foul call.
You can challenge the call. Do you want to challenge it?
Is it going to be a foul on them? Is what I'm asking you.
Sorry, let's go. I'm not going to answer any more questions. I just gave you three answers.
Warning. Can it be reversed or no?
Yes, it
Vaughan.
Can.
26. That's what I needed.
Right.
Yeah, no love lost between those two. What did we make of that one, Kane?
Well, this has been a bit of a pet peeve of mine for a while when it comes to the coaches' challenges because, to me, the question that Simon was asking was the wrong question. It doesn't matter whether the foul is going to be switched to the defensive side. I know it counts for the penalty and all these types of things, but what he should have been worried about was the fact that it wasn't a foul if you looked at the replay. It would have been an offensive foul taken away from Joe Chi. You already had Brandon Ashley with three fouls in foul trouble. It was the third foul on Joe Chi. So for forget the fact that it's going to be reversed. Worry about your own big man that's going to be in foul trouble. And I think sometimes with the challenges still, we're seeing emotions take over a little bit. They're focusing on the wrong things. Mm. I think the coach's challenge should be used on protecting your own players, your star players from foul trouble. That was a perfect opportunity.
Great job, Vaughn.
We know your stand on this.
I thought Vaughn handled it beautifully. Simon was clearly emotional. He's been cooped up in COVID protocol for a while. He comes out, he's a little bit hot under the collar, got a little bit confused with the questions. And Vaughn tried to explain it to him 3 times. And then Vaughn said, I got to move on. I got a game to ref.
Yeah. See, this is why I'm happy we've got 3 guests on the panel, because we've got someone who can decide, cast a deciding vote. Which of those arguments is more compelling to
you? I'm with Kane on this.
Obviously, this is just a bit that Damon is running with. We get it. You like sucking up to the officials. You don't play anymore. You don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, no, I'm definitely with Kane. I feel like...
just rubbing it in, yeah. Definitely.
Yeah, sorry, Dave. Kane's spot on. I feel like, you know, Simon should be focusing on just calling the challenge and getting the call, not worrying about what's going to happen after that. I think he should just make the challenge, go for the call, and then have that play reversed, because it clearly was not a foul. Yeah. Definitely should have been reversed.
So. Absolutely. But as we say, a point of contention. One that's always going to draw varying debate. Now, back to the game. Ryan Brokhoff, he has just gone from strength to strength in the last couple of matches. We've been waiting for it, haven't waited to kind of see him hit his straps, and now it seems that he's doing just that. 18 points, 8 boards today.
Yeah, Kath, and I mentioned this a couple of weeks ago, and I still really do believe that Ryan, he's that key player, man. When this guy's going, even when he's not shooting the ball that well, look at him being aggressive here, getting to the rim, getting to the free throw line. I think he was, 10 for 11, I think, from the line. You know what I mean? So when his shot's not going and he's still being aggressive defensively, especially, I think he's the key to these guys going all the way.
Mm. Ryan is not a one-dimensional player. We probably initially thought last year, the year before, even his whole entire career, that he was just a three-point shooter, a catch-and-shoot three-point shooter. Ryan is now showing us that he is a complete basketball player. He's made it a focal point to get on the glass. He had like 15 or 16 rebounds the other day. He dove on the ball on the floor one time to get it saved. It was huge. So he's just showing an all-around team game, which I'm really liking to see. And he's putting the ball on the floor again to the rack, which is getting... That's how you get free throws, people. Get to the rack.
Rocket science.
Well, that's a great point you make. And Simon Mitchell, who I have a nice working relationship with, he always makes the right decisions. And he's been telling me for ages, forget about the fact that he's a three-point shooter like you've been saying. He can do so much more. You mentioned the free throws today. 11 free throw attempts on Thursday night against Sydney, 12 free throw attempts.
Huge.
That's a different Ryan Brokhoff. He's starting to feel comfortable. And yes, the three-point shot isn't falling, but as long as he can impact the game in other ways, they'll be fine.
Yeah, exactly. Jack of all trades at the moment. Now, time for your harden up. You were just delivered one a little bit there. Time for your right of reply.
People of Australia.
That's a national address.
You know it's not personal. So, anyway, this harden up goes to the people. The well-intentioned, well-educated staff, high performance, medical, that's told Adam Ford that Scott Machado should only play 9 minutes, which clearly he played more than 9 minutes. So my thing is even though you're trying to protect the player, you don't understand the warrior mentality. You don't understand the grit, Kane, the heart of a warrior. Warriors belong on the battlefield, not on the bench in a polo shirt eating up all the lollies. So just leave those guys alone. They will tell you when they're tired, when they're hurting, when they can come out of the game. Leave them alone. With all due respect, harden up.
Yeah, I hadn't seen Adam Fawn's medical degree. He's got an ability to read that sort of stuff, does he?
He's been told things.
Okay. We'll just go with that. Now, we have production meetings before we go on air, of course, but unfortunately we've neglected to inform Damon of a certain element today. Okay, Neil, got a bit of a surprise for him.
Damon, it's not personal.
Look at his face.
Hard enough is never personal. And we saw today what can happen towards the end of a game when it's a close game. Me and you, great friends, by the way. We're at the game on Thursday night. One possession ball game between the Phoenix and the Sydney Kings. Sydney Kings, and Damon says, there's about 50 seconds left. He says, sorry, I just got to take a quick break. Goes for a toilet break in a one possession game.
Did the nerves get to you, did they?
Soft, brother.
Harden up, Damon. You and your bladder.
Okay,
hit
you with a harden up.
I knew I would have the whole toilet to myself if I went at that time.
Did you make it?
The bladder wants what the bladder wants, people.
Did you make it back in time?
I got there.
Okay. All right. You're an efficient man. All right. We are going to another break on that note. We are breaking down, of course, the clash between Perth and Melbourne United last night, right after this. Joala Chul, he was incredible last night. 22 points, 13 rebounds, just continuing from strength to strength, and a couple of monster dunks as well. That's coming up next. Back time now for the Amy breakdown. We are going to look at the United Wildcats clash from last night. Majuk with a monster dunk there. Unfortunately, we don't win games with single moments all the time. So 93-87, the final score. United getting the win last night. It was a really slow start for Melbourne though, but they managed to rally.
Well, this was the reverse of what we've seen from the Perth Wildcats over the last couple of months. They're actually leading a game by double digits through the first quarter. And the reason for that, Bryce Cotton was scoring. He hasn't done that in the first quarter, but unfortunately it flipped pretty quickly when United were able to get on top on the defensive end.
Yeah, 31 points for Bryce Cotton last night. I suppose it's that thing of, though, when, you know, they're not all firing. If it's just Bryce or just Vic on a given night, they might suffer.
It was only a matter of time. Soon as the Melbourne United, over time, they will choke the life out of your offense. Mm. Now, they gave up that lead early. They just reeled them in gradually. They took Vic Law out of the game. You got Jack White and Mason Peatling. I'm going to call you guys Jason Wheatling. Combined, combined, they just choked the life out of Vic Law.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just, you know, as a defensive unit, they're too deep defensively. So good on the United.
Yeah, and another element that was good for United was Chris Golding. He had 16 points, I think it was, in the second quarter, and it contributed to that 37-point quarter for United, which really turned the game.
That's what this guy does. I mean, don't let him get hot. He gets one look at it, you know, that cup starts getting a lot bigger to him in his eyes, you know what I mean? And he doesn't need a lot of room to get it off.
Mm.
I mean, he comes off picks, he comes off on balls. Look at that, not a lot of room at all. And just with the ultimate green light, this guy can get you going. He can spark your whole offense, which then leads into their defense. This is just an all-rounded, you know, mature team, this United team.
Yeah, and another element in terms of individual performers, Dellavedova he had 18 points, but I think it was 11 in the last quarter, so massive down the stretch last night.
Winning time. Dally, the scorer, and there was a lot of talk about, obviously, Shea Illy. We mentioned it on the show last night that Illy might be the guy that spends a lot of time on Bryce Cotton. He did a fantastic job defensively, but in the fourth quarter, it was Dali putting the ball on the floor, getting to that free throw line area. We know, as you can see there, that shot off the glass has been money for his entire career. And he just got physical. He got physical with the Perth defense, got to his spots, and put points on the board.
I loved his little one-legged Dirk Nowitzki shot just then. Dele mania, there's still a little bit signs of it. It's still in there. Yeah. And between him and Shai Ili and Dele, I'm going to call... No. Between the two of them, they wore Bryce Cotton down. Even I know Bryce still had 31 or 32 points, but between the two of them, yeah. And when Shai's making threes and Dele's scoring like that, two beats one. Mm-hmm.
I touched on it a little bit earlier, but is it concerning for the Wildcats? I know Mitch Norton last night, I think he had 21 points in the end, so he did his bit. But in terms of, you know, when those guys, around those guys, when those guys around them go mm-hmm. missing, it mm-hmm. can be a bit costly for them.
Yeah, I think so. And I'd like to hear what you guys have to say about this. But it's a tough line for me because, you know, obviously Bryce and Vic, together these guys average like 43 points a game. You know what I mean? So... I feel like the offense is built around these two. They both average 20, both arguably the best in the league. And having maybe added other guys that maybe need the ball a lot more in their hands, take 10 to 15 shots a game, might actually take and negatively impact their game. I'm not sure if adding players or other guys having more of an impact would help. But at the same time, it does when obviously guys like Vic Law are having a tough game like he did.
They're trying to figure out who the third guy is, as you pointed to. So even last night, 31 for Cotton, he had 12 for Vic Law. So 43 points. They're averaging 43.7 per game. So they're right there on that average. And then you have to go right down to Todd Blanchfield. He's averaging 10.5. So they're not really sure at the moment who the third guy is. And we should acknowledge it's a completely different dynamic for this Wildcats team. In the past, they've had that post presence, the big man presence. John Mooney last year was spectacular. Nick Kay, we know, was a star for multiple years with the Wildcats. So they're still trying to figure it out. And when they play a team like Melbourne, again, Jack White is an incredible defensive player, then they become a perimeter-orientated team and they rely on the jump shots. And if Vic Law can't get it going in addition to Cotton, they are going to find themselves... Again, we're talking about a championship credentials. They could struggle.
That third spot, that third score, it's a raffle.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's Michael Frazier, the second. Mm. Sometimes it's Luke Travers, Mitch Norton, Blanchfield. It doesn't matter. As long as it's one of those guys. But don't forget, Perth is getting ready to go back to their home country and play a whole bunch of games at home with their 13,000 of their mates. And all of a sudden, we're going to see they just might run the table.
Yeah.
It's only one matchup we're talking about with Melbourne, particularly because of the big guys we're talking about. When you have JLA, you have Ariel Hook-Porty. Mm-hmm. It's one matchup that maybe is a difficult one for them. You're right. They're going to go home. They're going to be fine.
Yeah,
we're absolutely. Talking about yeah. a potential grand final. Yeah, so that's where course. We rate Perth.
Yeah. It's a nice bank of exactly. home yeah. games to come yeah. home to as well. Before we go, I want to talk about that dunk again from earlier today. We've seen a couple this year. We haven't got too much time left, but where does it rank in the likes of Creek, McDowell White? Number one?
Oh, easily.
Yeah.
Easily.
It's not even up for debate.
Yeah. Well, you were debating a little bit before.
Nah, it's not up for debate. Jalen's got it.
Especially because yeah. we were just talking about it too.
Yeah.
You know, whether Jalen really did have bounce like that and he just yeah. proved to us.
Incredible. We're going to play it over yeah. and over again. Kane Pittman, Damon Lowry, Marley Biondolo, great to have you company again. Stick with us tomorrow night. We've got Cairns, New Zealand wrapping up round 11. Enjoy.
This program is brought to you by Hungry Jack's and Amy.
Do they even want us to do this, or what's the deal?
I'm sure they do. Yeah. It's just, I don't know where the guys are that facilitate it. We're the tech guys.
So
we can't really
the same respect that we get on the floor is the respect that we're getting now, it seems like. Do they even want us to do this, or what's the deal? Do they even want us to do this, or what's the deal?
I'm sure they do. Yeah. It's just, I don't know where the guys are that facilitate it. We're the tech guys.
So
we can't really
the same respect.
It's almost hard to know where to start, James. That's a tough way to lose a basketball game.
Yes, tough, but the build up from this week's of practice and the commitment and what we did Friday night and what we did this game, we're starting to go in the right direction. It's obviously it's a tough loss, but there's a lot of positive signs.
Is that what you try to tell the group? Do you focus on the positives and the fact that, I guess with 17 seconds to go, you were in a winning position with possession, or do you focus on what happened in those last 17 seconds and try and make sure that doesn't happen again?
Well, two games ago, we gave up 102 points. We just gave up 71. So there's obviously positives. There's some execution things that we need to take care of, which maybe we didn't put ourselves in a situation like that. I'll take responsibility for maybe not putting the right guys in rebound situation at the end there to get that missed free throw. Maybe we're playing in overtime. So there's a lot of certain things where maybe we're questioning ourselves, but I can't fault the effort. And that's what we've been talking about since the beginning of the season until now.
Following up about your defense, their backcourt is pretty dangerous, but Jalen Adams and DJ Vasiljevic, you did a fantastic job defensively on both of those guys.
Well, yeah, credit to the boys. We have a choice, you know, every day, and the choice is to sit down and defend or not to. And if you don't want to do that, then somebody else can pick up the slack and do that. And so that's the identity that I want moving forward and throughout the course of the season. And for sure, this is, it hurts to lose because they recognize the effort and the work that they've been putting in. And it was like, damn, that was tough. Like, nobody likes to lose, but we can, like, wow, all right, fellas, this is the standard that we can do. It's capable.
Jace, you know as a team that you did a lot right. How tough is it to then walk off the floor taking that loss?
Yeah, it sucks. Worked our ass off. Once again, got no help, but we worked hard. And so when you drop one like that on the road and you're in a position to win, like you said before, it hurts even more. But also on the back of what JD said, we're doing the right things. We're going about it the right way. We're missing one of the best players in the comp. A lot of positives. It just sucks that it's not sitting in here talking about the 2-point win we had or whatever.
That was my next question. You must be proud of what you've been able to do as a backcourt unit this weekend without Soaps.
Yeah, of course. And it's always challenging when a big piece goes out, especially when a lot is built around him with the ball and what he brings to our group. And so he's actually done a really good job. The growth in Soaps talking and helping other guys while he's been out has been really good. And it's given other people a chance to stand up and play. And so obviously someone we would love to have on the floor with us, but right now we don't. And yeah, we should have been 2-0 this weekend.
You haven't given up many points in both games this weekend. What have you been able to improve defensively this weekend from the Cairns game, Jace?
Well, we played Cairns and we realised that we were just like they were just allowed to hold and kind of be really physical with us and we didn't respond to the physicality and we didn't do a good job of it. And so then we play that Cairns game where we kind of like I left that Cairns game with more bruises than I've ever had in my whole career. And then we go, well, we got to get more physical, boys. We're not physical enough. We don't play hard enough. We've got to get on that side of the floor. And so I felt like our whole week of practice was brutal. We were after each other. We were into it. We came out Friday night and showed it, and we did it again tonight. And sometimes it's viewed differently, the physicality, which is hard to get used to. But I thought we did a good job of transferring kind of what happened to us last week into these two games.
James, you've now got a full week to prepare for the Phoenix on Saturday. What are you focusing on, and I guess what do you need to do to get that win on Saturday?
First thing is recovery. Get home, recover, recharge the battery, chop up the film. Obviously, what we did last week produced some good results for us. So we're gonna get back at it.